Mr. Frazier is excused this evening. Mr. Percassi. Mr. Seiber.
Here.
Mr. Moss.
Here.
Mr. Lance.
Here.
Ms. Seymour.
Here.
Ms. Members present.
Okay. All right, we're going to follow our procedure since there are no outside people here on the agenda. We're going to go directly to communications. And the first person requesting recognition is Pamela Gerald. Ms. Gerald.
Pamela Gerald, P.O. Box 155, Southfield, Michigan, 48037-0155. My telephone number is 248-352-9188. Since May or June of 2011, the city of Southfield has not had a permanent chief. At one time, there was at least 7 to 9 candidates for this position, and I can stand to be corrected on the amount of people vying for the position. I have passed out to you of which your council president has taken from you, but I have copies. I passed out 3 documents. One was the city's official posting for the police chief's position. The second one was a copy of Acting Chief Eric Hawkins' resume. And the third one was a copy of Acting Chief Brian Gerald's resume. I am not, and I repeat, not advocating for any one particular candidate. I do not care. What I'm concerned about is the process by which this very powerful position in the city of Southfield will be selected. It is purported that Acting Chief Brian Gerald was guaranteed this position by members on this council. If that is the case, if those allegations are true, the process is already tainted. It was also purported and alleged that if any other candidate came before this body, that those members would not vote for anybody else. If that's the case, the process is already tainted. I'm very disappointed. I'm very disappointed because we're supposed to have this standard, and this is not looking like a Southfield standard. If these allegations are true, then every other candidate, and I also have their resumes and their names, have automatically been discriminated against, either based on their race, their education, because they meet the requirements, or the fact that they are beyond Southfield borders. And I just want to say one thing in reference to this requirement process. The first sentence, it says, requirements for the chief of police position, bachelor's degree in a related field or equivalent, master's degree preferred. Now, if the master's is preferred, it seems to me like before you can get a master's, you have to have a bachelor's. Where did this equivalent come from? And did it say equivalent when Dr. Chief Joseph Thomas applied for the position in 1991? If it didn't say equivalent or experience, the process is tainted. This is unacceptable, and we, the residents of Southfield, who are at the top of the organizational chart, will not tolerate this contemptuous behavior from this administration. There are also other serious allegations that 2 members of council, and that would be the president, John Seymour, and Mr. Lance, these are allegations, are are going around to the police officers in the community asking them, who do they want to work for? These are allegations. I don't care if it's true or not true, but if the allegations are true, the process is tainted because you guys are voting for this person. And that's not fair. That is not a Southfield standard. Now, you should not be talking to the officers, telling them that one person is qualified over the other if you're making that selection decision, of which you are. You are the body to do that. You should not be talking to those officers, creating a culture of intimidation and fear that if they express that they want to work for one person over the other due to mannerism, integrity, their education, that is not your business. Now, if I'm wrong, correct me. But don't correct me if you don't have the facts. Don't correct me if you don't have the facts. Again, I just want to say that the citizens are at the top of the organizational chart. There's also allegations that members of this administration is talking in a very derogatory way about the other acting chief, and his name is Eric Hawkins. If that's the case, that process is tainted.
Your time is up, Mr. L. Your time is up. Thank you for your input.
And residents, I have passed out copies of the resume and the posting. If you want a copy, please see me for it. Thank you very much. Nancy threw the copies away that I provided to the council.
The next recognition, request for recognition is from Mr. Gerard Mullen. Mr. Mullen here. And Mr. Mullen, if you could give him an address for the record, and we have 5 minutes.
Madam President, my name is Gerard Mullen. I am proud to say that since 1968, I lived at 17880 Louis Street. And since 1961, I have worked in the city, my city, the great city of Southfield. Let me tell you folks just how great the city is. At the last council meeting, I raised the issue regarding the extra...
Not drop of the handout flyer, Pam Carroll. Yeah,
at the last council meeting, I raised the issue regarding the extra envelope in my water bill. Within seconds of adjournment, the city treasurer, Mr. Irv, informed me that he was working on this issue. And this evening at 6:15, Mr. Charette informed me that the solution was near. Wow, now that's what I call great customer service. This is why I live in Southfield. And not in the great city of Southfield, and not in Latham Village. Although I hear that Latham Village has a first-rate fire department that provides terrific EMS service. Tonight, I'd like to expand on that theme of eliminating enclosed envelopes in the water bills by recommending that the water department do emulate other public utilities by offering residents the option of going 100% paperless. Now the city can save even more money and kill even less trees. Hence, Southfield can be known in the future as the Super Tree City, USA, and the leader in the race towards a paperless society. Also, I'd like to remind council of the second issue that I raised last week, that of the leaky water gate valve at the end of my block. Guess what? The next morning, the valve was fixed. Now the city's two for two. This is why I live in Southfield, in the great city of Southfield, and not in Lathrop Village, even though I hear that Lathrop has a pretty good school system. Thank you, Madam President. Thank you.
Well, good evening, everybody. I appreciate the opportunity to be here.
Good evening.
acting director on the building.
Acting director. For those of you who don't know me, I'm Kerry Comfort. I am the acting building official. Just a little background on me is I've been here for 26 years serving the community, and I'm a registered code official with the ICC, as well as a state registered building official, inspector, and plan examiner. And tonight we're here to give you our ideas about the sign ordinance. We would like to focus on three key parts of that ordinance, and this is our presentation tonight was put together by Edgar Della and myself. Ed did the majority of the hard labor for it, and he will be also stepping up tonight to do part of the presentation as well. So I'm going to pass out some booklets and you can follow along. Southfield at some of our major intersections. also impact on legal basis to regulate traffic safety and community aesthetics. So we don't want to, we want to be careful about an electronic sign ordinance that would kind of open up the ordinance in the city for electronic signage everywhere. So we want to be careful where we put them and how they're going to be regulated. So we came up with the following ideas that we would like you to consider. New technologies for gas station pricing signage. There is a different technology that we want to show you tonight that we haven't seen in the city, but we think it's a great idea and possible real benefit to gas station owners. We want to discuss electronic signage and also overlay zones for signage. And we will be expanding on the description of what an overlay zone is and how we plan to use it to better increase our signage program for the community. I wanted to put this up here because Mr. Shrett recommended it, for one thing, but also to give you an idea of what kind of experience our inspector has. He's got 20 years experience in the sign industry. That's before he came here. Experience in sign design, fabrication, installation, service for all types of signs at multiple companies. He's helped develop standards for sign installation as a member of the Midwest Sign Association. He maintains a sign specialist license. He's that from the state of Michigan. And he's had that for over 20 years. He's got a bachelor's degree in the industry from Eastern Michigan University, and he's a registered building inspector and plan examiner, and has been so for 14 years. With that, Ed, I'm going to turn Ed over, and he's going to take over the technology and the technical aspects of this.
Hello, everybody, and most people know me.
If you want to pull the podium over a little bit, because the mic is closer to you. Okay.
That's pretty good. When we came to council the previous time, we really wanted to look around and see what kind of unique new ideas were out there for especially gas station signage. I really think that it came across pretty well that it doesn't make sense in this day and age to be sitting out there with a stick in the wind trying to put a little letter up and stick it in there and whether the weather's bad or it's icy or whatever. So I had been driving around and actually noticed a new type of sign that's out there that is controlled with the same controller that controls a whole bunch of different types of signs, electronic signs, changeable signs, etc. Only this particular type of sign still gives you the impression that it's a traditional sign. It's not electronic as far as the lighting. It's still internally illuminated from the back side of the sign. There's no exposed bulbs. There's no glare. There isn't anything like that. That's a traditional one that we have right at the corner of Evergreen and 9 Mile. It's a little large one, but it's this technology that I'm going to be showing you. These are actual individual number units on a device that turns, so that you have 1 through 9 or 0 through 9. And they turn, and they're controlled by, there's another example of them, they're controlled by either a handheld unit that you can walk around with, a corded unit that you can walk around with, even to the point of they can be changed from a cell phone also. They also have that technology, so the person doesn't actually have to be on site to change the price of the sign. This is one that's actually in Dearborn Heights right now. Kroger is using them almost at all of their locations. They don't have this device on the side of them anymore. This is an early one, and this is the controller box. They've now incorporated that inside the sign, so you don't have to have this big box out here. But these numbers actually change. They're behind the plexiglass front. They're illuminated from the back. So it's actually pretty unique. They look like a traditional sign. You get the illusion of a traditional sign, but you don't have any of the glare or anything like that. So they read really well. They read as good as a traditional one, but they don't have any of the glare or anything like that. They can be changed just as easily from inside the location. You don't have to go outside. Change the price, I guess, as many times as with the way gas prices are going up and down and up and down, you know, you can change as often as you want. Right now, our current sign allowance allows for a maximum of a 20-square-foot sign, which is non-electronic right now, for a product price sign. That's about a 4-foot by 5-foot sign. It can be attached to the ground sign. It can be attached to a canopy or the wall. Any of those places it can be attached. So some of the advantages of this technology are that there are very minimal changes to the existing ordinance. All you would have to do is edit the actual definition of the sign itself, add that in there so that this type of sign was allowed. So that's all you'd have to do. The allowance is already there in the sign ordinance for product price signs in the section for special use for a gas station. So very minimal changes, one paragraph. It does provide excellent visibility. No glare, it's internally illuminated, no visible bulbs. Can be designed to fit in the existing signage that's out there. They can remove the product price sign that they currently have, because most of the signs are designed to have the top panel that's the information, whether it's Sunoco or mobile or whatever, and the bottom sign, the pricer, is always a separate unit itself. So they can pull that out, leave the other section of the sign in, and put in the new pricer. Obviously, it has all the advantages of quick changing from remote locations. You don't have to touch the sign to change the prices, and the changes do appear almost instantaneously. So, one of the other good things about this, the numeral size is actually 10 inches versus 8 inches. It's actually larger than electronic message signs or signs that you would see, LED illuminated signs, which are fall under the overall umbrella of an electronic sign. The electronic message center terminology really encompasses a whole bunch of signs, all the way from gas station signage all the way up to tri-vision, full motion, video characteristics. It's also, believe it or not, it's more cost effective. They're actually cheaper, slightly cheaper than a comparable size electronic form. They're right now in extensive use. They've been using them here at a lot of the Krogers. I've seen them at some other places. They're in extensive use down south, but they're also used quite a bit on the eastern part of the U.S., mostly in communities, and this is straight from a couple of the manufacturers, that have an emphasis on aesthetics, that maybe still want to have this ability for a gas station to change their sign easily, but maybe would like a little better look or the aesthetics to be a little bit better. This is a perfect example of one of many. I think we have 3 or 4 Valero stations in the city right now. It's actually in Valero's program. It's actually something that you can pick within Valero's sign program. So it's an option for them right now. It's also an option right now for Sunoco. It's in their program, too. There's a list it's a little hard to explain sometimes how signage gets out at gas stations. It's a whole issue with what they call the jobber, who is the person who sells the signs and sells the actual franchise to the gas station owner. So that jobber would have the ability to get these types of signs for other manufacturers too, whether they were Mobile or Marathon, and I've talked to some sign companies about it already, local sign companies that actually provide these signs, and they know about the technology. So the conclusion, since it's a pretty easy change, and I think it's something that we'd really like to see in the ordinance as an option for these people. It's a very easy way to do it. We'd like to see if there's a consensus from the council to make this change to the ordinance, a very minor change. So that's one of the things we're asking for tonight. Okay. Next. Kind of a joke. So, just a funny electronic sign. Okay, so here's some ideas that we came up with, going back a little ways, for electronic message centers, creating an ordinance for them. So these are just suggested parameters from staff. These are just some things to think about from staff. Keep in the major thoroughfares, possibly 8 Mile and Telegraph Road. Don't put them at high accident rate intersections. From doing the research on how they've been adapted in other ordinances, some of the areas that are a real concern are obviously having them near intersections where their timing may confuse people with the timing of a traffic light. The last thing that you would want, obviously, is someone paying attention to a sign, either not seeing the traffic light change or looking at the sign as they're coming up to a red light and not knowing that. So that's a big issue. In order to get some idea on how well regulating you can be with them, how well you can regulate them, whether you can control certain aspects of them. I've seen this in other communities where they've actually tested them in areas until they can get an idea of how they're going to work and how well they're going to be able to be regulated from some of the negative effects that we talked about earlier, scrolling, things like that. Obviously, almost every ordinance that I've read places a key concern of this type of signage in residential district or facing residential areas. Because of the repose of residential neighborhoods, the use of electronic signs in a residential neighborhood tends to be not in character to a residential neighborhood. I think most people would agree that people wouldn't expect to see a flashing sign either in their front room or even if the light was just changing, even if you can't read the message and the intensity of light is changing on and off or doing any of that, that wouldn't be something that would be really consistent with a residential neighborhood or, you know, the lights in a residential neighborhood. The reason I brought up the accident issue is we have some pretty high crash intersections in the city of Southfield. Third highest crash intersection in Oakland County, Telegraph Road at 12 Mile, fourth highest in the region. That's pretty intense intersection. 11th highest Southfield Road at 10 Mile, 13th highest Southfield at 13 Mile. This is a little bit farther down. I picked another one within there because I didn't personally think, although I now that I think about it a little bit, Evergreen Road at 12 Mile. There is a lot going on there, too, with the signals. There's some other possible limitations you could have in an ordinance of electronic signs, which I've seen a lot of ordinances out there. Try and limit the output of the lighting. Try and reduce it in the evening. There happens to actually be some ways of actually putting meters on the sign itself or right adjacent to the sign that can keep track of that light. That's one thing that you can do. You can obviously limit how fast the message changes so it doesn't change and change and change. Generally, however, there hasn't been a real clear standard on that. It's been anywhere generally as low as 4 seconds, as high as 10 seconds in that range have been generally accepted time frames. You could limit the size of the electronic message center to only a portion of an existing ground sign and have it a maximum size. You could trade it off for other signs. So let's say you said, okay, you're going to be allowed an electronic sign, but you're not going to have this is going to be your only ground sign, and maybe you're going to trade off some other type of sign that you have out at the site. You could put them at a little greater setback from the property line than the 2-foot setback that you have for general business zones. You have some setbacks in the sign ordinance that are real close to the road. And I think by increasing that distance from the road, you would help with the visual distraction. You could regulate the distance between them. Pick a 400 feet, 500 feet, 1,000 feet between them so that you don't see them lined up on every single property. You could regulate, obviously, as I was stating, regulate the distance from any intersection with a traffic signal. These are the pitfalls that I think we've always talked about. Obviously, legal challenges. I don't think I need to say anything more than that or get into any greater detail of that. We can't regulate the content of the message. So if there's something displayed on there, unless it's, you know, going over the edge where it may be untrue, pornographic, libelous, things like that, that's a different issue. But as far as being able to regulate what they're going to be able to display on there, we're going to have a hard time doing that. They can also advertise businesses and products that are not located at their particular site or in Southfield. Obviously, billboards and other non-conforming signage. Billboard companies are probably the leading group that brings legal challenges to cities over signage issues. Most of the key cases in the legal review of signage were generally from, as a result of, the billboard companies filing a lawsuit against municipalities, states, etc. It's really hard to deal with the quality of the display. It's hard to regulate that. It's hard to, as I think we all know, a lot of products are coming from various parts of the world now, whether it's Korea, China, etc. So as far as having standards for a quality of the display, it's pretty hard to do, other than requiring them to be a UL-listed underwriter's laboratory so that it's not going to shock anybody or burn anything down. Other than that, the quality of the display can vary widely. The quality of the lighting components can vary very widely, depending on where they're manufactured and how well they're manufactured. Of course, you know, possible pitfalls are the negative impact on the aesthetics of any community. Just wanted to show you, that's one of our billboards on Telegraph. Thankfully, or I don't know whether I should say that, we have two billboards in the city. We have one on 8 Mile and one on Telegraph. Both happen to be in industrial zones. Okay, I also have a video presentation. It's probably about 5 minutes long. I think we're going to shut the lights down a little bit more for it.
Ted, do you just want to kind of let them know what the video is going to show them, like the quality of the sign?
Right. I'll stand up there and I'll explain it. Here we go.
This is across, it's just about in Telegraph.
So what I want to show here is that obviously the signs can do a lot of things. The effects, even if you, let's say you limit the effects to you want to change every 6 minutes, you'd also have to talk about how the effects are going to change. Gets into a little more of a detail on how they're actually going to change. Do you want them to just appear? Do you want to allow them to fade in, fade out, move in, move out, come from the left, come from the right? There's a lot of ways that they can be operated. This is actually, believe it or not, probably a better quality one than a couple of them you're going to see. Multiple colors. This wouldn't be considered a full tri-vision or a full video presentation. That's probably about the best it's going to get. Here's another example, probably of a little lower quality sign. That's also on 8 Mile Road. So you can see the message can be brought in several different fashions. The reason I want to point this one out in a minute here is about the quality issue. What happens with LED signs or any electronic sign is what you get over time, these are all burned out on the side. So depending on the quality of the unit that you get, depends on how long these light bulbs, let's call them light bulbs even though they're diodes, how long they're going to last. So when you get something like this where you have a burnout or a section of it burning out, really the only choice is to replace all of them because you'll have different intensity. A diode, a light emitting diode, goes through a cycle, a percentage cycle, and they're actually considered unusable when they get to about 40% light output. They're considered unusable. So they have an actual lifespan to them.
This is something that's pretty common at all the CVS pharmacies that have electronic signs. Single color unit. I'm trying to show you different ways that the message can come in, as well as different styles of boards. Sometimes, on some of these boards, you'll see it coming up. In an attempt to get the lettering as large as you can get, you'll see coming up, they'll actually end up cutting some of it off. So these are some of the challenges that you have when you have these types of signs, is that as far as being able to accurately control how the sign is going to look, you have a lot of variables there. You have a person coming in, could be a new person operating it, might not be as good as someone else, so you're cutting that off. You know, so you've got the person operating it, you've got the system itself, and you've got, you know, how big a message do you want? Here's another example along Woodward of one, yeah, that Royal Oak Decks. It's in Royal Oak. Mm-hmm. This one gives you an example of also a full color one that is actually being used to advertise other things. So it's advertising Titanic, the musical. It's also being used, as you're going to see coming up, to advertise Office Depot, some other types of places that are not on the property at all. None of these things are on the property themselves. So they're being used to, whether or not, I guess conceivably you could use them to sell, you could sell space on them. So you could use them to do that. That's where the conversation is being able to use them for products and businesses outside of the city of Southfield. I've actually seen some along some other major thoroughfares at a workout place that actually advertises attorneys. So it's not unusual that they can be used for other things going on other than what is at the actual store. And that's an area where we would have an issue with being able to control that content. So, for instance, Blue Cross Blue Shield, that's not on the property either. Chamber. This one goes on kind of long. Sorry. It's actually a fairly high-quality board, and there's probably maybe three manufacturers that are really high quality. A lot of them that are coming in now are coming in. Companies are going over to China and actually setting up their own manufacturing factory to create these signs with LEDs over there. Don't have real good control over the quality aspect, where these other companies have been around for a long time. Here's, again, another example of one, probably maybe a little bit fast-changing, a little bit... So what I'm trying to show here is there are high-quality units and there are low-quality units, and there's some in between. It'd be very hard to regulate the quality of units, depending on, you know, what someone wants to pay, obviously. And the speed at which, so for instance, if you're trying to regulate something and you're saying you don't want any flashing, you don't want any rotation, you don't want any of this, you could have that set up, but the speed at which someone can change it on their computer keyboard within a couple of minutes. So here's another example of a unit that someone's trying to use to do a little bit more than what it should be. It's a low quality unit with a lot of individual LEDs, but it doesn't look very well. It doesn't, it obviously it's a cheaper unit that is not as defined as other units. Here's another example of one. This one actually, the reason I have this one up there is to show you that some of the units can put full pictures up there. Some can actually run full video. So that's one of the reasons for showing you that one. We're pretty close.
And that's in Detroit, right?
It's right across the street. That is at Northland Drive. Oh, okay. That's it for that. So, the conclusion for us is, I guess, what do you guys want to do? We have a consensus whether you want to proceed with a limited EMC ordinance. So what we're doing here is we broke this presentation into three parts, and we're asking the council to give us some direction as to what you'd like staff to do. The last one, this is something that we've been working on, building department and planning department, going back years, probably at least 10, are discussions of special signage allowances for overlay zones. This actually is an overlay zone that was created for the London Olympics. They actually have an overlay zone created for them. That's just a graphic from the first start of the of that plan that they have. Definition of an overlay zone. I know this is kind of technical, but it's a map zone or a mapped area where you impose a set of requirements in addition to the requirements in that underlying zoning district. So for signage, it would set aside a specific set of requirements for signage that would be different than what they would be normally in that underlying zoning district. They're generally applied when you have a special public interest in a specific area that doesn't coincide with the underlying zoning boundaries. And I think we've talked about, you have city center, you have the DDA, we're talking about additionally 8 Mile and Telegraph Road. They're very unique areas, and they have some unique sign issues to go with them. So we're talking about some boundaries here. We're talking about the 8 Mile Road District. We're talking about properties that have direct frontage along 8 Mile between Greenfield and Inkster. Everybody knows that. Telegraph Road, properties having direct frontage abutting Telegraph Road between 8 Mile and northern boundary of the city, about 15 miles. So here's the district map. These little pieces are the actual properties that front. Well, they're a little hard to see. Gives you an idea of the amount of properties that are along them. Same thing for Telegraph Road, properties that go along here. Okay, the other districts that we'd be talking about would be the DDA. Defined borders at 8 Mile to the south, Mount Vernon to the north, Greenfield to the west, and Greenfield to the east and Southfield to the west. And the Southfield City Center. The defined borders are City of Southfield Civic Center, areas generally bounded by I-96, the Lodge Expressway, Evergreen Road, and the LTU campus. This is a picture, a graphic of the Southfield City Center District. Kind of gives you an idea. I know you've seen this before. Downtown Development District. Gives you an idea. Northland right here. Mount Vernon up there. Okay. Some of the additions that we'd be talking about. Telegraph and 8 Mile Roads. When we have large parcels on Telegraph and 8 Mile Road, and they have a lot of frontage on 8 Mile, or a lot of frontage on Telegraph Road, they're limited to a 60 square foot ground size. When you have an extremely large parcel, that's a pretty small size. So we'd be talking about increasing that area for the main ground-mounted signs, and in some examples like Lair, Kamau, Northland, increasing the directional sign allowance too, because in those types of campus settings, the small directional signs that are allowed in the ordinance just don't work. We've had cases and cases before the Board of Appeals increasing the directional sign area so that on those large parcels, they're large enough to move people around, move traffic around. I think when the directional sign allowance was originally created, it was mostly thought of as, an enter and an exit for a fast food place or something like that. It doesn't work for the larger campus. We'd also like, I know this has been brought up before in conversations about the number of tenants on a ground sign. We wanted to see if there's some other way. I looked at other ordinances to see if there's other ways to do this. Because to be quite honest with you, I can find very few places where they actually give a number of tenants. So we'd be talking about replacing that hard number with some size and style requirements. We still want to make sure that you can read the sign. That's clear. It's still got to be big enough to read, and it still has to be, the letter style has to be readable. But if we can get four on there, we have enough room to get four on there. If we can get five on there, as long as we can read them, I don't think it's necessarily a negative thing. I think when you get to the point where you're trying to get 12 and their lettering is this big, that's an issue. Because it doesn't make it so that anybody can read any of their message. So replacing that hard and fast rule with something that's a little bit more flexible. We also want to blend the requirements from the 8 Mile Boulevard Association into the ordinance, just for the design and material standards, so that we can blend in with the stuff that they're doing along there. Now, that's just the design and materials. That's not saying that that would in any way supersede our ordinance for area, size, location, et cetera. It's just to understand that it would be nice to have those districts take that into account, because they have done some work on it. We also want to add some landscaping requirements to the signage in these districts. In the ordinance, in the sign ordinance, have some requirements so that instead of a ground sign going in with no requirement whatsoever, just stick a pole in the ground, and maybe we start looking at something around the sign and make it look a little bit better. We want to add the design standards and the district logos and colors somewhere on the sign so that we can get some sense of it being a district, so that the signs go together, so that they kind of look like they belong together instead of this sign's this, this sign's that. So if you're going to create a district, an overlay district, you do want to have some consistency in what the signage looks like. We also have, especially along the 8 Mile and Telegraph areas, we have properties that are very close to the, we have buildings that are very close to the property line, because they're older sites. We've done this at the Zoning Board of Appeals, where we have exchanged the allowance of their ground sign to allow them to use that on the north and south, or east and west, depending on if it's 8 Mile, sides of the building. And they don't get a ground sign because there's nowhere to locate one. So we've done this at the Board of Appeals, where we said, okay, well, you only get this much for one wall sign. What about a second wall sign with some more of your allowance that you have for your ground sign, so that people can still see north and south or east and west without having a ground sign because they don't have a place to put one. The DDA, same issue really, the DDA and city center. We have the same, we kind of have areas that intersect, obviously, the DDA and 8 Mile, and so we're going to have some areas of intersection. Same thing. These sites, Northland, IBM, Town Center, Oakland Town Square, are big parcels. We end up at the Board of Appeals anyways, dealing with these sites, whether it's on a directional issue or whether it's on the number of signs or the size of the signs. Because, to be quite honest with you, in some of these large parcels with large frontage, having a single allowance of 80 square foot, 60 square foot, or whatever, it doesn't deal with the enormity of the actual site. Again, we want to do the same thing here, replace the tenant restrictions with size and style requirements. Same thing. We also want to add landscape requirements for the ground signage. Same thing, design standards for the logo and colors of the district. Same thing. This is a new thing some new items to add into these two specific zones to give them more of a pedestrian feel and a little better with pedestrian traffic. One would be, you see this a lot in downtown areas and in urban areas where they have projecting signs that stick out from the building. We can set a limitation on how far, the spacing, etc. We can do all of that. But this gives them a change in just a flat mounted sign. Because if you're walking down, if you're walking as a pedestrian down a walkway, you're going to have to constantly walk like that. These kind of give you an idea and a real nice feel of what a restaurant may look like or some other use may look. So it'd be nice to have that as an exchange so that, you know, if someone decides, you know, that's a good idea. Most of my traffic is pedestrian traffic, and I'm in a location where a sign flat on the wall doesn't help me from a distance from the road. So it'd be something nice to add. We want to add wayfinding signage. I think everybody's talking about that. Most communities, whether you go to Ferndale, Ann Arbor, Royal Oak, various areas, they have a coordinated effort of not only directional type signage, wayfinding signage, and they all are tied together with a theme, an idea, and when you look at them, you think, oh yeah, I must be in this specific district, and it helps you lead from one place to the other, whether the wayfinding signs are a directional map. There's, by using the term wayfinding, there's a lot of things it could be. It could be audible information. It could be all kinds of things. It's a general term. So we'd like to add the ability to have those types of signs in these particular districts. Also, streetscape banners kind of help give an identity to an area. We're talking about banners on light poles, things like that, that could give an identity to that actual district too. And one of the big issues, I guess, for the Zoning Board of Appeals, more or less, is that we only have one specific size for signs on the top of a building, whether it's a 5-story building or a 30-story building. You get 200 square foot. That's it. Everything else goes to the Board of Appeals, you get 200 square foot. We have a good amount of experience from the board knowing letter heights on these buildings because we've seen them. So what we want to do instead is have not only some thresholds that grow as the building grows for area, but letter height that grows. So, for instance, a 3-foot tall letter may look good on a 5-story building, but it's not going to look good on a 30-story building. So as the increase of the building goes up, the increase of the height of the letter goes up too, and obviously the area is going to go up. You would have to have it. Another issue is that we really don't have an anchor store allowance for tenants in malls. So we have, it's a little hard when you're dealing with a Target or somebody like that who's an anchor store who comes in and, quite honestly, they expect more signs because they're taking up more area. So that's another thing that we'd like to add. So, on the overall sense, this is just kind of a quick run through on this. Obviously, this would have to be done along with changes in the zoning ordinance. The districts would require an identity more than just a single logo design. So the identity would have to deal with materials, colors, standards, besides just a logo design. Obviously, it's going to be a coordinated effort between business, the city, everybody, including, since the city hall is in this downtown district, that's another reason why the city is a stakeholder. It would require an in-depth study of the traffic and pedestrian, especially pedestrian movements, for the locations of these components. Last thing we'd want to do is get a sign in an area where, wow, why is that there? It doesn't work. And can't really be done in a piecemeal approach. We can't start it with one design and then decide, 5 years later that I guess we still could change it, but you'd want to do it more holistically and not piecemeal. So the review process that we use, some of the major sources, there is a model sign code from the International Sign Association that they have developed that they like to give out to communities to help them. 8 Mile Boulevard Association Facade Improvement Program, I looked at that as I stated earlier. There's a book called The Signage Source Book. It's a very good resource to see different types of signs, how they're manufactured, how they're installed, things like that. There's a book called The Value of Signs, how valuable signs are to business owners. Of course, we always look at sign ordinances from around the country and in Michigan. Zoning Board of Appeals case history. I always have direct interaction with sign companies. Always. I know most of these guys, and now they're sons and daughters who are running the company. And input from the planning department, and obviously input from the legal department. So the conclusion is, we're seeking to see if there's a consensus to proceed with adding some overlay provisions to the sign ordinance. So those are the three areas that we are seeking some guidance from you. And I'll return it to Mr. Cummings.
That pretty much does it for the presentation part of it. What do you think? Are we on track with anything? I know we got three main pieces of the ordinance that we looked at tonight: gas station pricing signs, the electronic signage, and the overlay districts. Like Ed mentioned earlier, the gas station pricing signs, it's minimal work to get the ordinance written up and put together, and we can get it right in. We can slide it right into the ordinance with a public hearing if we can do that. Like to get something like that consensus tonight if we could. I know there's a lot of information that you got, and I'd encourage you to look at your presentation books. And and there's probably a lot of questions. Yeah. I don't know how much time you have allocated for us tonight, because I know there's stuff, other stuff on the agenda, but we can take some time.
Are you ready for questions now?
We could
okay.
Open up
questions.
Okay.
Yeah. Mr. Gonzalez, thanks, because it's very informative. And
also,
I know this has been going on and on for quite a while, and I know it's very difficult. I think the reason it came forward really was the gas station prices. And then, of course, everybody was looking at, if you do it for gas stations, you know, do you have to do it for everybody? You know, and how do you control it? And the presentation was made at the time by Wayne Jewell, I think, of Mr. Gardell, that they were doing it by different zones. So anyways, I'd like to say that I don't believe that the present sign ordinance is any good. I see too many problems with it. And let me name two of them. And one I just seen last night. One is that mortgage company on 12 Mile Road that has a sign and then has a big bright yellow sign on its front. And that thing just lights up the entire block. And everybody across the street is very upset about it back when it was put in. I forgot what mortgage company. It's one that moved over here from 10 Mile Road. And then last night, I came by Beach and 9 in the new Valero gas station. They switched ownership at 9 Mile Beach on the southwest corner. And they have the sign that was permitted that the other gas stations had, but in every window are all inside the building neons, Lotto and Open, and but this one is like, I mean, you see it, boy, you light up, and you know it's a sign, but they're using that little, thing in that gray area that it's a sign, but isn't a sign, because it's in the window. Inside the building as opposed to outside, and I think that somehow has to be addressed. I don't know how, but I would just think that it has to be addressed. The other thing is that Southfield Christian just put up a scoreboard, and it's very nice, and they did a beautiful job landscaping so you don't see the stanchions, but I looked at it and I said, you know, this is, why don't we have our school logo up there? And they said, well, that is a sign. And I said, well, it says it was paid for by the memory of two families, and that's up there. What's the difference whether you put writing on it or you put, you know, the Southfield Eagles or whatever, or Southfield Christian even on it? And that's kind of hard, you know, for me to understand. Writing is writing, message is a message, and I'm not criticizing, but I mean, I just don't have a. Matter of fact, I told them there's a metal sign. I said, why don't you get some kind of thing that sticks on, and after the game, pull it off, you know, magnetic. But anyways, so those kinds of things ought to be some kind of consistency on what the definition of a sign is. If it's a scoreboard, I don't know. Southfield High, I think, has Southfield High on theirs, don't they?
They have Metro PCS on the back.
Oh,
is
that right? I didn't know that. So, but that's the school, right? They get that. Is that
Southfield High did.
Pardon?
Southfield High did it without consulting it, right?
Oh. Hey, Mr. Ed. No, but anyways, so that's another matter. I don't want to bring that up. And the other thing is that I don't see anything wrong with electronic signs if it's done right. And I point out Southfield Lathrop School, and to me, that has not really had a detrimental effect on on people, you know, and going through, I look past it 100 times a day. The only time I really noticed it affecting anything is when you have a low cloud or a fog and the whole area lights up because of the thing. And then the other thing is that our buildings that have height, Fifth Third Bank, I have no problem with. But the Aeon sign, I have a problem with. It looks like somebody painted a 4x8 piece of plywood and put a black AON on it and hung it up.
Well, I do have some good news for you. That's going to change pretty quickly.
And there's another one now that copied that. And there's another one that just went up that is 3 letters, and it's almost the same kind of thing. It's almost a copycat. And I forgot what building that's on. I think it's A something. I don't know.
Well, I do know the AON sign. It'll be changing very quickly.
And the last is really a question is that if, you know, going through Atlanta, the buildings are, some of the high-rise buildings are lit up. And it's really spectacular when I envisioned if our town center buildings were lit up from the ground, just lights, how spectacular it would be. So you notice when you're in the daytime, at nighttime they really don't stand out. But by lighting, it would really lay an impression on this city. And I don't know if that is considered then a sign, or how could we encourage, you know, that to be done. I mean, it would almost have to be same. But I think that would be such a unbelievable sign for the city that we are a business community as well as residential, but it would be a stand-up. On the different, in those layovers, I think that's what we talked about last time. We have different districts for those kinds, some kinds of signs and not in other districts. I think that's great. The only thing that I would add to that is that similar businesses should have the ability to have equal signage. In other words, you know, if there happened to be an occasion where in a district that is not included, but you may have light industrial here and then right next to it, you may have light industrial, but it's out of that zone. And this guy can have the same, but this one can't.
That's the key for the overlay zone, is that you deal with it as a whole zone, not as specific uses. That's one of the reasons for going for that, so that you can do exactly what you're saying. So that you, instead of, if you've got this particular use and this particular use and this, you have a similarity between them. You don't have these wild changes, this size sign, and then this person gets a huge sign. So that's,
It was like the overlay zone for Telegraph Road. That goes from 8 mile all the way to the end to 13 mile.
In
another overlay zone that we're looking at for possibly electronic signage, that overlay zone goes from 8 mile to like 10 mile.
Okay.
So you would have that case that on the other side of 10 mile, you wouldn't be permitted to have the electronic signage until you went on the south side of 10 mile. So either you have to elongate the zone, the overlay zone.
Now, I would think that if in that case that the overlay would take in similar zone properties.
Right.
So you wouldn't have that one person would have an advantage or disadvantage over the other. The last thing, this is a comment, I don't know if it's good or bad, but each time the DDA comes in and they, last time it was Cornerstone and last time it was something else and something else, you know, I'm very parochial, and this is the city of Southfield, and I just think there has to be a different way of them designating their area other than street signs and those kinds of things, because I think everything in the city should be kind of matching. In other words, whatever signage is allowed one place, we should have it throughout the city. Same way as you go into some cities and they all have a special signage, street signage. No matter where you go in the city, you know you're in that city because it's the same. And the continuity, I think, is very important, that people who come into the city know they're coming into the city, irrespective of it's in a cornerstone or city center or any other driving through the city, they know they're in this city.
Well, okay, you're talking about the street signs?
Yes.
Yeah.
It's out. Thank you, it's a great presentation.
Thank you.
Mr. Simon?
Yeah, I echo Don. This is, I'm a little confused as to where we're going with electronic signs. You showed us pictures of Oak Park, Royal Oak, Detroit. It sounds like everybody around us is doing electronic signs, but us.
Well.
And then, just my impression.
Right.
I mean, your information was helpful, and I'm not criticizing your presentation, but I didn't get a clear feel of what are you recommending in the way of electronic signs. And I'm not an expert on that. I would look to you for guidance. I certainly support your first suggestion on the gasoline signs. That seems like a no-brainer, and it's just keeping up with changing sign technology. But I don't really have a clear feeling of what you're recommending on electronic signs.
Right now, we're not really recommending anything.
Well, that's
we've thrown out some ideas as to what we can experiment with,
yeah.
And maybe that's something that we need to further develop. But from the last meeting, it was kind of split as to support for them and no support for them. So one end or the other, and there was one in the middle. So we didn't know exactly which way to proceed, and we didn't want to do a whole lot of work without getting some input from you.
I'm okay personally with taking a cautious approach and trying, as long as we come back and do some real analysis of it. If you want to take a cautious approach and set some areas and see how it goes. As far as driver distraction goes, I think there's more distraction coming from within the car than outside it. Honestly, today, with the computers in the cars and people texting and on the phone, and it's got all the things you see people doing as you're driving down the street. I saw a guy playing solitaire. I couldn't believe it on a handheld bike on 10 Mile. I guess he was winning.
he didn't crash.
Yeah.
And then there are a number of other suggestions you make in here. Are we to give you feedback on these one by one, or
they make
sense to me. I mean,
right. And when you get down into the really deep stuff on each one of them, I guess what we'd be asking are they all your concerns? Are some of them more concerning to you and some aren't as concerning to you as far as how to regulate them, or if you want them regulated or if you don't want them regulated? So we're just, trying to come back with exactly what was asked for, which was some ideas, and kind of get some more direction from council to see, what you want us to do, what direction do you want us to go in, what do you want us to regulate, what don't you not want us to regulate, and then we can put that information together and we can, try and get a tighter presentation to you where maybe at that point it's just numbers, how many, what size, how far apart, whatever, So we have some direction on, you want us to go back and you want us to look at it, put some real guidelines together. That's what we need to know.
I don't, your question about how many names, I think we ought to loosen that as long as it conforms to the size. I mean, I don't care if there's 3, 5, 6, just as long as we're not putting up signs that are just way out of proportion. I mean, that to me makes sense. I mean, we're working with the businesses to, we shouldn't be a hindrance to them, but at the same time, it's an aesthetic thing. So I think you've given us a lot to think about. I'm just not sure how
how we're going to accomplish getting the feedback you're looking for. Thank you.
Mr. Lance.
Yeah. You mentioned, Mark, about City Hall is in the downtown district. Have you bespoke?
Yeah, the city center district. Sorry.
The city center?
Yes.
Oh, I thought you said the city. City Hall. Okay, doesn't matter. Your presentation was very, very, very good, and I understand it. And I look for you to tell us about regulation signs. I have no idea. You haven't. So I believe the next presentation where you will get you're going to get a consensus, we like it. I know that. But you come back to us and give us the regulations that your experience will make up for us. I can't give you the regulations. And I'll depend upon you to do that for us. But everything went well. I agree with most everything. But I tell you one thing. I passed some electric signs and I can't read them. I don't know. The letters are small, but it's shadowed inside. It's the glass covering that sign. I think that's the problem. So you have to relate to some of that. They have to be seen.
Yeah.
Look, and then you'll have trouble in your car.
Now,
will a permit be necessary?
Yes.
Boy, I'm happy. There's a lot of signs that are going to be go up in Southfield, but how much is a permit going to be?
Permits are depending on the size of the sign. They can range.
At least we'll be taking on some money, Jim.
We'll probably have to
we'll be covering our costs.
Fees for that.
Yeah, that's a good idea. All right, I'll stop there.
Thank you, Mr. Moss.
Thanks. Good presentation, very good. And good to meet you, Ed. I've not met you before, so it's good to hear from you. Just a few thoughts and questions, actually. I think we could definitely loop in the business community on this as well, just because, this isn't just for fun, and maybe it is for fun, but it's also to kind of put a proven economic boost to different businesses. So if we can loop in the chamber or anything like that to kind of say, what does the business community want? What are some of their needs? I think they might be able to give us some guidance on what does work, a 6-second overlay or a 10-second. Do people need it longer? Do people want more at once? So I think maybe even the next steps, we could loop in the chamber or some of the business community. And also, if we do really look at these zones, loop in some of the neighborhoods that might be affected as well, just so the community doesn't get so upset about it. I could imagine if we put it in the city center and Lawrence Tech was involved, we'd be hearing a lot from Circle Drive, for example. So I think it's really worth reaching out to our neighbors who could be affected on their way home and might find it want to add their voice to the discussion. In terms of standard or best practice, of the communities around us, what are some of the things that they do? What are some of the examples of loose regulations, and what are some of the examples of more of the strict regulations? Just so I can get a sense on the map as I drive through the region, what works and what doesn't. Do you know that offhand? Or?
Yeah, I know a little bit of that offhand. Obviously, Detroit would have the loosest of any of the restrictions. Unfortunately, from being in the sign business for a long time, a lot of the signs get installed in Detroit actually, be point blank about it, get installed without inspection, without permits. Mm-hmm. It's a big city. It's a big city to control.
Right.
I think it's pretty loose in Garden City and Westland. If you go down Ford Road, the dealerships along there have full motion, very, very large signs, full motion detail, explosions, movement. So those two communities, and then you go all the way up to, let's say if we go up Telegraph Road, you go up to Birmingham, Bloomfield, where they don't allow them. So there are communities that don't allow them, and there are communities that do. And then as far as how well they've been able to control them, I can tell you some communities, I know for a fact that from reading the paper, that Livonia was challenged on their time frame. I believe it was 8 seconds down to 4 seconds, and they just gave up and went ahead and gave it to them at 4 seconds. And that sign's actually off of 96, off of the freeway. So, I think as far as controlling actually their display and how they display, it can be a pretty tough item to do. I haven't really seen, I've seen in communities where they have both. They have signs that are doing this, and then they have ones that look really good.
Yeah.
I don't know whether that's a function of enforcement or whether or what it is. I have seen these types of restrictions as far as movement, this and that. I've seen them in the ordinances. They're in the ordinances. But sometimes when you go through the community, you don't see it comport to what the ordinance says.
Right. And I guess to kind of piggyback off of that, some of the possible pitfalls, you know, I guess, are any of these true of non-electronic signs? I mean, any of these would be true of non-electronic signs for the most part, you know, negative impact of the aesthetics of
sure.
the community.
Sure.
So it can any of these individual ones be regulated? It says cannot regulate content of messages.
Right.
Can you expand on that? What's an example of something that's just so outlandish that the city, if we pass an ordinance like this, we really are kind of tied behind our backs, you know, with our hands tied, that we can't really say this is what you have to have on the sign?
Let's say there's a business in another community that you're not really excited about being advertised on something, or a product that you're not really excited about being advertised on something, or an event maybe. I can't give you specific examples. I think everybody can get a pretty good idea. And, you know, it's to personal taste, too. What one person might consider, I don't like that, that might be offensive. Someone else might not think there's a problem with that type of message that's up there. But as far as being able to regulate the content, unless it's an illegal message, it's a use, it's something that's, you know, pornographic or something like that, going to be an issue regulating it. Yes, we have an issue regulating it on a traditional sign, okay? But generally, the difference between an electronic sign and a traditional sign is that the business owner is going to want to have his name on that sign, because if he doesn't have his name on that sign, then nobody knows where he is. The difference in an electronic sign is you can slot in those.
Yeah.
You can have your name for a while, then you can have something else. Then you can have your name, then you can have something else. So you can actually end up, I do know that you can actually end up selling those spaces depending on how often you want to make the change. And like I said, it's all the business owner. If the business owner wants to give up his sign that has a fixed message on it to someone else, I don't think you would see that. I haven't seen it in Southfield, and I haven't seen it anywhere else.
But you do see it pretty regularly on
electronics. Absolutely.
One other thing,
yeah.
Jeremy, on that is that currently on a fixed sign, you need, if you change the face on it, change the copy on the face, you got to come in and get a permit for it. For an electronic sign, you just got to go into your computer and you can change whatever you want.
Okay.
So you lose a little bit of control to that piece of it.
Okay. Another question was on the burning out. Doesn't the city have something where if you have a sign,
yes.
And a letter is burned out on it, you have to get noticed and you have
yes.
to fix it. It just makes it more complicated with this because it's such an endeavor to fix it?
Yes, and that the choice in the ordinance is if you don't have full illumination, you need to shut the sign off until you can read. You know, we give them a period of time. We're not ridiculous with it, but you shut it off until you can get full illumination. The problem is on some of these, this type of technology, it can get very costly to do that, to replace that, and to keep it in that manner, to keep it functioning in that. Now, if the business wants to invest that type of money in the sign, you'd hope that they would invest to keep the sign running properly, looking good. You don't always see that even from someone who may invest in a sign up on a high rise. They might be able to try and keep it illuminated, but, you know, it's a challenge in those become more, a little bit more of a challenge. So imagine, you know, you have 5 light bulbs lighting something, and instead you have 1,000. So.
Okay. So the first one I think is pretty easy to say yes to. I mean, it makes perfect sense, and for the most part, I don't think people will even know the difference. But the second one, I mean, yeah, let's just loop in the business community because, you know, they probably might either have chains elsewhere or they have ideas that they wanted to implement, and we can have a discussion back and forth. But I think this is something to really kind of keep on our radar. If it is business and business community wants it and helps the local economy, I'm in favor of it.
Thank you. I have to agree with my colleagues. This is a great presentation. Good information to make some decisions. My first question has to do with the gas station sign that you're recommending. Why would you prefer that over the electronic sign? I mean, with gas stations, if this one is, you get a consensus for this, how do we know gas stations would prefer the electronic sign?
I don't think we necessarily know whether they would prefer it or not, but I think by changing the ordinance, it's another piece that we could allow them to do. That's
so we would give them an option of this one, or
if that's what comes out. This one's a super easy, super fast situation where I do know that it's available for quite a few gas stations. And it really takes care of the issue of doing it. It's very readable. It's not harsh. It's very nice looking sign.
I agree. I guess I'm in favor of electronic signs. I think sign of time and the fact that Southfield has not changed its sign ordinance to reflect that. But I think we're at a good juncture to do something about it. But I would prefer giving the gas station the option in the electronic and let them decide which one they would prefer as to us just saying we've got to go with this one that's before. I would like to see some consistency throughout the city, you know, and not just restricting it to the overlay zones, you know, when you look at Telegraph Road or 8 Mile Road, but take it all the way down from 8 to 13, you know, Southfield Road all the way, but make it consistent. And not separated by the zone. So we'll just have a more difficult. I would like to see us, and this is my opinion, begin with ground signs. Start there and making sure that we've got landscape around the ground signs as opposed to the tall. I'm not sure I'm in favor of the tall signs that are lit as of yet. But I think if we can just start with the ground signs only, making sure that they're landscaped. We can kind of get a picture on how this is going to look. I would like to see churches to have the opportunity to have an electronic sign. You know, our maintenance guy goes out there, you know, once, twice a week. You know, he's working, he's 70 years old, and we're requiring him to change the letters and change the signs. When an electronic sign, nice ground landscape would help. So I would like to see the church community added to that as well. But again, I think we should start with ground signs only and not go with, you know, that whole tall one, you know, like 8 miles. And I want to talk with what Mr. Moffitt stated in terms of can we regulate if part of the sign is burned out, saying you've either got to shut it down or repair it and not allow a sign that's damaged or broken. I mean, if you're going to make the investment as a business, you've got to keep the sign up.
Yeah, we do that.
I would like
it's
to.
In the ordinance now.
That's my opinion.
All right, Mr.
Pekowski.
One last question.
No, you can't have one.
Oh. what percentage of cities now are using, if you know that, electronic signs?
I don't know that now. I would have to get that information. It'd be by, you mean by region?
You can start with Oakland County. You can start with Michigan. You can start with southeastern Michigan. Because I've seen them.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. And I see that it would even enhance the city's appearance. Thank you.
Mr. Kaufman.
In offering the gas stations that new concept, is that different than offering gas stations electronic and no one else electronic? Can this be offered in some fashion to to other businesses, that same thing.
That's interesting that you brought that up. There's a couple other uses. One of the uses would be for hotel pricing. Anything that has an individual, obviously anything that has a price. Yes, it could be.
And so they would have the same leniency to do that. To me, I think that the gas stations and whatever that new product is, I think that is something that I would like to see offered as soon as we could get it on the table to get it approved. That would be something that gives some guidance on to see if my colleagues agree with me, because I think that is something that has been needed for quite a while, is the ability for that, because it changed so often.
Yeah.
I mean, it's not a sales promotion necessarily. It's for us letting people know. The other thing that I seen coming here tonight was 1-800-LAW, whatever it is.
Yeah.
And they got this nice pedestal sign up, and that's fine. It's pretty big, but it's all right. Now there's this big, long sign. What is that?
That's the wall sign allowance on that beautiful building. The allowances at that site have actually grown since it was rezoned from B3 to RC. Sign ordinance allows for larger signs in RC than they do in B3, which is what it was originally zoned. However, we went to the Board of Appeals and we tried to make a mixture of the two. It's kind of unique that the one side of that building actually doesn't have full Losser frontage. If you look at the building, there's actual the cutaway for the affiliated diagnostic use centers. So they have a very small part of their building that actually is considered for the sign area. But the other side that goes towards the road is still pretty substantial, and it's at a 2-to-1 calculation, 2 square foot for every linear foot. So what the owner did was take that total allowance and break it up into a smaller sign, because he gets one facing Losser Road according to ordinance and one facing Northwestern. He took that allowance and made a smaller ITT sign so that he could have his 1-800 law firm as a larger sign. You don't regulate content, obviously.
No, but I mean just the size of it.
Yeah. Actually, it's the letters aren't as big as you think. I'm sure they look big, but the general allowance in RC is 200 square foot. So,
well, you know, I mean, I seen that building before that 1-800 law was done, and I said to the marketer, to my wife, I said, boy, does that ever look classy, because they painted all the cement, and now the facade matches before it was different color gray. And I thought the sign along Rochester Road was classy, you know, and it boy, when I seen that big thing across the base, I mean, I think it, from my standpoint, it really took away from the beauty of the building, and I'm really surprised that they did that. And they should have really been discouraged somehow from doing that. I know that June 5th, they're going to have the grand opening, and I'm going to tell them, guys, and I know he's an attorney, but give me a break. He really destroyed the looks of a beautiful building. You know, that was as bad as Pinner Flowers sitting up there in front of your building. I just assume they should have left Pinner Flowers to cut a deal or something. But anyway.
Would it look better if it was flashing? 1-800
Yeah, electronically.
So that's part of the considerations you can't let go by you is that every sign you see in the city, not careful how we introduce electronic signs. They could be all over on every building, as big as the signs are now. And
but doesn't the Board of Appeal at least have some discretionary aesthetics powers that may step in and say, yeah, you can have, according to the ordinance, you can have the sign. However, guys, you know that's going to be ugly. It's terrible. But anyways, and then do a, and actually I'd like to see 8 Mile Road and Telegraph Road come back to us as a zone for signs. And I'd like to see it go to our state limits because we have the auto dealers. There are 12 Mile Road in Southfield. I think that would be the experiment, really, to see, you know, what... And I think I would eliminate, you know, the amount of time that these things could change if they want to put up the price or what their monthly deal is. That would be all right, but not, you know, 6 seconds or 5 minutes or whatever. I'd like to see them be allowed to put up a monthly deal or special weekend or whatever, some kind of a message up there that I don't know how, it's Sue's problem.
Yep.
But, you know, so we could defend ourselves in court by something that, you know, I would, you know, these sign guys, and they would go to the extent that they delete, you know, you tell them it's 2 and they'd go 7. But I would really like to see that done, and it's all electronically. You know, we were the first ones to break the law here at City Hall when we had electronic sign up in front years ago. So, and it never hurt anybody because you couldn't see it.
And
let me add this, that word in the ordinance says that landscaping be under the sign. Let me say this to you, that the compliments from the church people, because they put these large arborvitae up where you see the stanchions, and they beautifully cut in. I think they put about 8 large trees in there, and everybody said, man, and that looks sharp, you know, and you had so much compliments from the people who paid for it, you know. And so I think where we are ahead of things with landscaping and hiding those stanchions, that's great. And I think we're doing a great job there. Like I said, the mortgage company and the Neil Valero and, you know, that 1-800-LAW, whatever it is, get lost law or something. But, I mean, those are the kinds of things. I don't know how you differentiate and say this is good, that's bad. But it's up to, like you said, like Jeremy said, it's up to the beholder. But I sure am going to tell him that really distracts me.
But you had somewhat of, in the video, you had some idea of what, how the messages can be portrayed and displayed. And I don't know if you felt comfortable. Most of the ones that you saw that would blast a message and go out, they were under 6 seconds. And somewhere, there's one that was just, the letters stayed there in the background and went from black to white. So the letters, it looked like the sign was flat, the letters were flashing, but they weren't. They were continual. But I don't know if that's a concern of anybody. I think somebody said to regulate how fast or how long the sign is displayed. And we're kind of looking at things that you don't like to, like if you want to try to control things that we control is possibly the flash time or the display that the message is up. We can't control what they put on it, what it says, or what type of picture they put up there.
For the way it
I'd like to also pick up what Ms. Jordan said, and that is, maybe we just allow them with bound signs, so that you don't have the stuff up there, Lincoln, and some distances. Then again, I agree with Ken, you know, today with all this garbage in the car, I mean, you got these people looking at this stuff and driving and combing their hair and putting makeup on and doing this and doing that. I can't believe it. So they're driving down. I was going downtown. She's driving on and she's got both hands up there. She was at her knees at the wheel. I don't know.
She was a pro.
Yes, she was. She had that new what do you call it? No hands driving.
Daddy,
her car was. should set a time and a day and whatever, and probably goes by itself or something.
Might be when they're heading for driverless
vehicles. Yeah, just last week, last Monday. Holy cow. And she's really cutting, too. She's at going 10 miles an hour. I mean, she passed me, and that's why I've seen her. I don't go slow. But anyway, that's all I have coming. I think that I do recommend going to the gas station. Let's start out with that. Yes, thank you.
I thank you for your presentation. I was waiting for you to list the seven habits of effective signs or something. I want to say that the churches, and the gas stations were the driving force behind really my constant push for us to review this. I do want to say that the churches are in that the group where they constantly change their message. And I would think that they would, at minimum, because some of them are in residential areas, that we give some exemption to the churches because they are in residential areas. And the other part of that are the schools, because most of our schools are in residential areas. And, I mean, if we could regulate, say that you can't have a certain voltage of light after a certain time if you're in a residential area, if the signs are illuminated. But our schools and our churches, I would think, because they are predominantly in residential areas, if we totally exempt residential areas, I don't think we will achieve the goal we need. Lastly, I want to say that the most recent sign issue that came up was for the Shriners building, and they said that that is one of their major deterrents for people using that building, is because it says the Shriners building, but say, for instance, Pat and so-and-so's wedding is there. They would love to be able to say that the PTA annual dinner or so-and-so's wedding is here or something, but their signs, you know, you are the person that has talked about the most at in the city. But
not the most.
You have to, man. But I like the fact that we're looking at, and I've had those issues, you know, with businesses that have that restriction on the number that they could put there. But I think we're on the right track. I agree with Councilwoman Jordan, I would not want to limit restrict the gas stations to only use one technology. The problem is that they are elevated, because mostly all the signs for them are elevated, so if we do the no elevation, then we're kind of...
Yeah, there's another issue with that, too, is that most of our gas stations are on very small lots, because they're older gas stations. So most of the signs have been granted waivers for corner clearance issues. So one of the reasons I know everybody doesn't like a tall sign in a gas station, but realistically, when you come up to those corners with those gas stations so tight in the corner, if you have something that's solid and only goes up to a certain, you're going to block the visibility of people being able to turn. So that, unfortunately, because of where those ground signs are located, that becomes an issue, too, that it's very hard to lower the height on them so that you don't have an underclearance underneath them well enough for people to see around. So that's why you generally see pole signs or pole-mounted signs at older gas stations where space is at a premium for signs, because they don't have anywhere else to put it.
I guess this question will go to legal. This is my concern. I think the technology of electronic signs is a no-brainer. I mean, the world has changed, and the ability to do it. However, I don't want scrolling signs. Mm-hmm. I think they're distasteful. I don't want this burst of star, boom. I think it should be a sign that you can change electronically. I don't think any sign that's on top of a building should be electronic. I just think that, oh, my goodness, I can only imagine what that would be like. However, I do think that I wish that there was a way that we can say you can only have a set message, and say you can only change the message once, because we can't say we can't change it.
Right.
Once an hour or something.
Right.
And then it has to be a stationary sign.
Right, and we can do that. We can indicate that there can't be the explosion type things and the video type things.
Mm-hmm.
And we can do that. That just that when you get into, say, an hour, that could bring some type of
well, how do you say it can't be?
Well, you do, and there's ways of saying that in terms of the movement of the way that the lights are moving. You can do that. You can define that so that it is just kind of a stabilizing message for a certain period of time. And, you know, it does go all over the place. I know Ed mentioned six seconds, 4 seconds.
Mm-hmm.
I've seen ordinances that go 15 minutes, something like that. So the longer that we do, probably we'll be more subject to attack, but that's okay. I mean, if again, we're trying to maintain a certain, for traffic safety purposes, aesthetics purposes, I think that we can at least try to make those kind of changes. The problem, too, you know, we keep coming back to churches. We've got to recognize that if we do it for the churches, we really are opening up the whole city. Because most of the churches are in residential neighborhoods. And so once you allow it, and I don't know how you could simply say, well, their churches and schools, even though they're in residential neighborhoods, they can have it, but nothing else in a residential. I think you're really, now you're getting almost into content. You're getting government favoring, say, religion over non-religion. And you obviously, when you make...
Well, we don't have anything else in residential at home. Those are the only two.
There's a bunch of uses. There's recreational facilities, fraternal lodges. I'd have to go through. Terry would probably be better at knowing all the uses, special uses within residential.
That's the problem.
More
than gas stations along the major, those are pretty easy. I think those make sense. But it's just when you go into the churches, because of where they're situated, you really do open up probably every district, every zoning district. Because most every ordinance that we've seen really do talk about not residential districts.
Well, if that was the case, because we do need to do something for our churches, then that technology that you propose, because if you're in a residential area of a permitted use,
mm-hmm.
and you are permitted by a sign ordinance,
mm-hmm.
to have a sign, you have one anyway.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
What we're talking about is the ability to electronically change the sign.
Right.
So is that technology that you recommended for the gas stations, is that available?
Do you have letters?
No, I'll have to find that out for you. I don't have that information to find that out. One of the issues I think that Sue's, at least from my review of other ordinances, as far as being using any electronic signs in a residential district, is I guess the understanding that the residential district in most sign ordinances, I would say in 99% of them, is the most restrictive zoning district, period. Smallest signs, lowest signs, et cetera. So if you make the leap and you say, okay, now we're going to put a display in there that is more consistent with something that you would see in a commercial sense, okay, you now are saying, well, you previously had this district was very restrictive and you were concerned about, you know, the repose of the evening, you're concerned about all the negative effects from signage in a residential district, but yet you allow this type of sign in a residential district.
But I'm saying whatever the ordinance is, if mm-hmm. you're in a residential area, it stays the same, but we are allowing an electronic ability to change the sign.
But then the problem is all the effects, then, of the lights and the illumination.
Well, just say
the
lights have to be only a certain wattage in a residential area. And you can put the lowest wattage possible.
Then you get to a factor of the sign not being readable then. So you get to an issue with that.
I don't care if
it's
in a residential area.
We can look at that. We'll have to look at maybe how other cities have dealt with that issue. Because that will be the problem. Once you allow it in residential, it's going to be very hard to restrict it anywhere else.
And I haven't seen a district.
Yeah.
I haven't seen a city. It's usually pretty much they're all over.
Except for residential.
Right. You know, and then if they're in residential, they're all over everywhere else, too.
Right.
You make no allowance between this type of use or this type of use. You just say they're permitted, a percentage of the ground sign, et cetera, but you open it up for everybody. You don't try and limit it because you're going to have challenges.
Right.
You're going to have
absolutely
legal challenges on a religious basis, too.
If that same technology you recommended for the gas station
I will find that out
is available.
That would be perfect.
Yeah,
that would be perfect.
That's a no-brainer.
That really
would. Know
it
that would be
it would
perfect.
Go, because then the church could just sit in there and do
yeah.
the remote and
right.
find changes. That,
would
that's
it be possible to, like the mayor says, is to provide the
message to change, like, once a week, using electronic media to do it. So, and you could regulate it that, you know, it doesn't flash. It just, you can change it from one sign to the next, but you can't change it, you know, at all. Basically, you can't change it until you change the whole wording, and then it stays that way for a week.
Every night, pretty much?
But you're doing a revival.
You know, the other issue is when you do that, when you limit it to that type of limit, I really believe you're going to have a challenge on that issue. We don't have anything that clearly states, so if you limit it, then you have to have a governmental interest that you're protecting. We don't, even though, so if you're in the range, like Sue says, if you're in the range of what's generally accepted, the six, the whatever we come up with that's generally accepted, if you go far beyond that, like a week or an hour or something like that, now the burden of proof is on us and our legal department, because if someone challenges it, you have to come up with a reason why 1 hour is better for this one than 6 seconds is better. And we really don't have anything, any studies done on that to be able to point that out. So you're kind of putting people in a bind by saying, like she says, if it's in the generally accepted realm of what's been done before, that's one thing. But if you're going to go so far outside that where you're going to go 5 times what other people have, you know, people are going to want to display different messages. They're not just going to want to use it for that one message. Otherwise, why would you pay that much money for that technology if you're just going to have one message on it for 20 minutes or a half hour? It's a lot of money to pay for that type of message.
Okay, Mr.
Steinman? My question really was, can we ban multi-messages? And just have, I'm thinking of Phoenix where, and Ed, this is, you might want to check the City of Phoenix, Arizona's sign ordinance, but I noticed there that virtually every drugstore, CVS, Walgreens, they all have electronic signs. But if the message doesn't change, it's the daily special, whatever it is, you know, 2 liters of Pepsi for whatever.
And it doesn't change.
It doesn't change.
Yeah, it changes in Warren.
It always changes.
Again, in Warren they change it.
Well, maybe I'm just saying, yeah, but my question is, can we say you can't change it? I mean, you have to leave,
say for a day.
Right, yeah, it would be the length, then. You'd say, 24 hours, once every 24 hours.
You wouldn't allow multi-messages. I mean, the last time we had this discussion, it was, I think the consensus of those who were at the table was we didn't want this constantly changing, scrolling messages and all of that. We thought, appearance-wise, it didn't look good. Also, the issue of safety. I noticed that, I mean, they're really easy to read, those electronic signs that whatever Walgreens is advertising, you can't miss them. They're in red letters and so on. And you go down the street and you can read it in a quick second. So I would suggest you might look into see what they're doing, because I don't see them scrolling or anything like that. And I think if you get away from the 4 seconds, 8 second
mm-hmm.
argument,
mm-hmm.
We'd be better off. I agree with Sylvia on the ground signs, except, and I don't know if this would be prejudicial too, but it seems like you see motels with their room rates, and you see gas stations with the price per gallon, and those are fixed. I mean, they change occasionally, but they're up in the air, and I don't know if you can just limit it to businesses of that nature where they have,
No, you talked about the electronics thing only for gas stations and only...
Well, I like Ms. Jordan's suggestion of just having the electronic
ground.
But Ed is
right.
Absolutely correct
right.
about the gas station issue. So, and then I thought, oh yeah, there's that motel over on Red Roof or whatever that has their room rate. I don't know if you could do that.
Then you're really, you are really getting into the use and the content. That a gas station price sign would be permitted, that content would be okay, but somebody that wanted to advertise, like the batteries for sale, that's not okay. So you really are getting into
content. Then probably it'd be better just to do the ground signs, and then the gas stations have the option of, the first option we looked at, the illuminated remote control, but it's not electronic.
I'm thinking maybe you can help out. If we do district 8 miles to Telegram for 13-mile road, and we're allowing businesses to do ground signs, you're saying among the mile roads, we would not allow them.
Well, the thought was to maybe start with those 2 mile roads. And come up with almost a test and isolate and then see what works and what doesn't. So, for example, you come up with an ordinance for those two major thoroughfares, obviously where there's high incidence of accidents, that would impact what they could have. But you would come up with something so that those major thoroughfares would be allowed electronic signs. And you would then establish what percent of the sign you would allow them to have electronic, how often could it change, could you have the moving, could you have, you could go all kinds of regulations, and then see what you're experiencing. So it's just kind of a way of almost venturing in, saying that if electronic signs were going to be allowed, those would be probably the most appropriate answer, the area, those major thoroughfares. And you get a good idea then, how does it feel on those areas? And then maybe you go the next step from there, because you're going to learn a lot and see what occurs on those. So I think that's why you guys were looking at those two major areas as being the start.
Yes, and you know, I guess the cautious approach would be to try and nail down these effects and see how well we can, you know, what size looks good on a ground sign. How well are we doing with the effects? Are we getting quality displays? Things like that. So you could look at that and see, and you know, maybe we can work on better regulations or tighter regulations that actually work, and get a good product by doing that little bit of testing on them, I guess is the best way you say. And then come back again with a whole bunch of data from that particular little testing area or testing time frame. And just as if someone would say that, for instance, 1-800-LAWYER doesn't look the greatest. You might say, that sign in that, I don't like the way that looks. What can we do to develop a standard so we don't get another one that looks like that? So it's a way of kind of testing the water a little bit and being able to get some good data, too, back to find out, you know, how easy are they to regulate. What are we going to have a commitment from the business owners to follow the ordinance in a fashion that doesn't require a lot of enforcement or it looks good? So you could kind of get an idea from that to see, and then if the standards that you've developed, if you can massage them and work on them and then create it in a bigger area or in the city as a whole. Kind of, I guess if you're looking for something from staff a little more detailed, that would be it, would be to test it in a specific couple of areas and gather some more data. But in doing that, you'd still have to adopt an ordinance. You'd have to adopt an electronic ordinance, a limited electronic ordinance, and then put some criteria in there and say, you know, come back to council after we've got some idea on how well it's working. And if council seems that it's working well, then obviously council could request to have it citywide or something else. But I think if you're looking for something to come from staff, I think the most cautious approach would be to test it in some areas and get some data back.
Yeah. I just don't want to see us adopt an ordinance that is never expanded to include the churches and even not just the churches, but the other businesses that are on the mile road.
Right.
You know, our church is in a residential, but then surrounded by businesses, from Evergreen to, you know, Southfield Road, and I'm sure some of them may want a small size. So I don't want to seem like we're favoring one business over the other if we just limit it to a certain area. But I do understand the need for study. I do know that Farmington Hills, there's a church in Farmington Hills with an electronic sign, as well as there's a church in Troy on John R. with an electronic sign. I'm not sure what it means, but I know they are very nice electronic signs. But I do think we should start off with brown side.
Just a comment. If they took that 1-800, would they be able to put that up in the head to the cop head though? Instead of on the phone? You know, the building, your law firm?
Yeah.
It sits as a base to the big long sign on.
Oh, that's going up on the building.
Yeah, that's what's
going
on.
Yeah, talk about the cigarette lighter.
There's a certain, you know, I'm certain sure Sue could go a little bit more in depth, but as far as legislation and being allowed to regulate time, place, and manner, so you can regulate the size, so that it's, as we said, it's, I understand.
It's one of those kinds of deals, you know, where it's go to the limit. The other thing, I guess, is, I would be actually in favor of, I'd like, first like to see some of these other cities, what they have done with it. Even the City Hall now has one on Orchard Lake Road and one on 11 Mile Road, electronic signs. But I'd like to see how they've done it and how they've regulated it. And as far as the ground signs, is there the possibility if, for example, a gas station is too close to the corner, that they can be grandfathered in such a way that they could still be granted that digital or whatever your new kind
the
of
first technology? One, that would not, the way that the waivers have been granted for signs in the corner clearance area, it's not going to be an issue because it's simply granted that sign in the corner clearance area. And as long as they maintain the same under clearance, pull that pricer, the old pricer up, put the new one in, there's no issue other than obtaining a permit.
Okay, because on the Lancer corner, that is a ground sign gas station pricing.
Yeah, that's a low one, actually.
Yeah, yeah.
It's a little bit bigger property, but it's still pretty, it's up there still pretty close.
Yeah, yeah. But I'd like to see something, you know, I'd like to see some kind of a time element here. So this comes back to us either to review or for passage so that we don't linger on with this thing too long, I think.
How about we cut it in half, 2 years to a year?
Right? I'm getting old. I'd like to do this thing up before I go. Not sooner.
What kind of time frame are you looking at?
Name your poison. I mean, when do you think he's going to get ready to bring something so that we can critique it? You know, whatever. You know, I think you have to start. I think Ken mentioned it. You guys kind of come with a recommendation, something that you believe would take in all the things that you heard, and then we can sit there and drift it apart. But
well,
at least you'll start the discussion and get into some particulars.
Let's start the bidding at 120 days.
let's figure out exactly what we're looking for.
What
I understand that I've heard there's pretty much a majority.
Well, let me just say this. I'd like to see electronic ground signs in a certain size allowed anywhere in the city. At, for openers, and gas stations be allowed to change their signs to digital.
That
they be released from the ground side down. Because I have to say this, I really don't. You know, the one in Lathrop is for the school is really not a negative, and it's in a residential neighborhood, and I don't know if that size is, it would be the size that the churches would use, the stores would use, or whatever, but you know, but I think the size and being a ground size should be something that we all should agree on, I believe. And how long the message can be on there. I don't know what the church is on. Every day, is it? Or
probably once a day.
Once a day as opposed to every 6 seconds? 24 hours, say? And the other question I was going to ask is we have zoning that allows certain zones for different uses in certain areas. How come we can't do signage in the same manner?
We do.
Yeah.
We do. Depends on the zoning district, sure.
Right.
The sign depends on the zoning district, sure.
So, Mr. Picasso, you look at the ground signs, you said ground signs everywhere. You mean electronic message ground signs or ground
yes.
signs as a whole? Ground signs.
Well, I like to see them.
Standard
all the, I like to see everything be at ground level anymore.
So anywhere in the city, if a person elected to take a ground sign as opposed to some other permitted sign, if they went electronic, that would be okay.
It has to be a ground sign.
If it's a ground sign. In
now,
any district.
I need a little help. When you say ground sign, because you're using some terminology.
I'm using something as an example, Southfield Laser School.
Okay, so you're talking about something that doesn't have poles that go up in the air.
Right.
Okay. Could you use the term monument?
You could use, there's several different ways. Monument, we actually call them garden ground signs here, so there's other terminology. We call taller signs ground support signs in the ordinance. So you're looking at something, do you have a height maximum that you're looking
at? I could use that as an example. I mean, I don't know, that seems to be the height that seems
probably
to
about
be
8 foot tall, that one?
I don't know. You know, can I
No, the one at Langford?
Yeah.
I don't know.
Yeah. I think that, I mean, I look at that size and see, you know, I think the ones that Farmington Hills by the City Hall are too small, to be honest with you. I think they don't even, I mean, I can't even read them fast enough.
So we're going to regulate the state sign.
Part of it. 24 hours is what we want.
I think that we're going to look, but I think that one may be difficult to sustain. But we'll look at trying to get the most time between changes as we feel is defensible. It may not be 24 hours, but I think 4 to 6 seconds we can work on. But let us come back and do some more research.
How's that going to help you gas?
Well, because
they can go to the new
they can use the sign that they have now and convert.
Right.
Without changing their pedestal, right? Yeah.
Are you done, Mr. Chappell?
Yes, thank you.
All right, Mr. Lamb?
On 12 Mile and Rochester Hall, the corner wall thing, they have a big, huge ground sign. But they change the message every 15 or 20 minutes or a half hour or something.
Okay.
I go one way, they sell milk. Back to the restaurant, they sell the flu shots or something. But the different method every time, space at the time, I think that's appropriate. And if they're in business, the retail business, they have to advertise what they do. So we can make them have milk 249 all day and all night. That's no business. There's no benefit. That's a huge.
Yeah, the question was posed, you know, what do we want to see in 120 days? And I just want to emphasize a point that I hope didn't get lost a long time ago, was to reach out to the business community. Because we could parse over this all night long, but we could render something that's completely, you know, useless if the business community doesn't even want it, you know, that way. So I think that has to be one of the first steps going forward in order to do some sort of workshop with them and reach out. So if you asked for a wish list, I'll put that on there.
Okay.
Okay, I have a few comments. In a way, this sounds sounds like we're opening Pandora's box. This is going to be a huge undertaking to really, you know, get it to where it's going to work. There's a lot, so many elements to this. There's just so many elements. You're going to have to stay around for a long time. Let me know. Never mind. Okay, I have a few comments. One of the things that, apart from the electronic signs, I like the idea on office, on tall buildings, not the top buildings, not like we have over there at AOL, because I can tell you from where I am on the east side, when I look out to a beautiful sunset or a beautiful moon, I see AOL in that red banner among all the trees. And it's not really, you know, it's an impediment. You kind of try to ignore it, but you do see that. It's not going to go away, and I'm not going to make an issue of that. But the major tenants' names, I think, are very important in our business community. Not a lot of names are very small, but if you have, like, a town center, and you've got some major, however we decide to put them on there, so that it's showing off that these people want to be in our community. Microsoft. Definitely. You should have Microsoft name on the town center. I mean, that's huge. That's huge for us. So that kind of thing, I think we'd all agree, that's a feather in our cap to put those names on those buildings. Large enough that people can see them, especially going down the freeway, because that's going to attract other people into our community, and I think that's very important. I'm concerned about traffic safety issues. Flashing signs that drivers can see. I am concerned about that. I'm very concerned about aesthetics also, because we can become looking like a Las Vegas Strip. If you go down Greenfield between, say, Lincoln and 11 Mile, it's the first time I ever used to travel there from Detroit up to Birmingham for dinner and back. There are areas downriver that are like that, in the big shopping centers. It's just glaring. But I don't think we want to see that in our areas of our city. I'm concerned about, you mentioned billboards and other non-conforming signs. Are we getting problems from billboard owners because they want the same thing? Is that what you're talking about?
Yes. Okay. I actually have received a few phone calls from Mike Van Haften, who is the rep for the two billboards that we have in town. And they, his comment to me was they'd like to do whatever they could to get full motion billboard on both of those sites.
Okay, what's our protection for billboard?
Well, it sounds like right now the consensus is to go to ground signs only.
Well, but so they could come back and say, you know, they're being discriminated against.
Well, again, we're not we understand that, but we're not going into content. We're saying we're actually almost trying to promote people going to ground signs, the ground support
signs.
The lower signs. So that if you do that, you know, we'll rid some of the higher type signs that maybe aren't as attractive. We're going to go to a nice garden ground sign.
That would be the main part of
right. It sounds like right now that's all we're looking at, are the smaller, lower signs.
Okay. Quality display, you said that's difficult to...
Difficult to control, difficult to write in an ordinance.
Okay. And can we govern how they operate?
We can govern some ways that they operate. I think we've gone over that pretty much. We can try and govern how fast the message gets changed, try and govern whether there's effects on them or not. What else would you say?
The voltage, how bright they are.
How bright they are, yeah.
How bright they are.
Yeah.
So there are those.
So no flashing, no rotating, no video. That's part of that.
That would be part of that, absolutely.
Well, I want to say I think you've done a fabulous job in this whole study. I think you're going to concentrate on certain areas, and I think from what you've heard from council, some of the zones especially that we want to work on, rather than trying to hit and miss the whole, you know, work on one and move to the next so that we can get a good bit of depth in there before it comes back. That would be my preference.
Shelley wanted to see something. She's behind
okay,
me.
Okay, 1 second. I'm not fond of the electronic signs on the tall buildings, on the really tall buildings. Certainly don't want to see flashing signs up there. But you've done a wonderful job in presenting this and your studies, but it's just that you kind of have a lot of work to get this back to the family. I think we all recognize it. And so
I was just wanted to express my concern. I know a lot of the property owners really are looking for higher signs to get that visibility, and they have been on the medium to high rise buildings.
What kind of signs? You mean lit signs at night? Things that light up at night?
Yep.
Well, we have to look at that. We have to look at all of them because, you know, we can end up looking like, say, come down River Shopping Center. It just doesn't look like.
Vegas.
Yeah, Vegas Strip. You know, I don't think we really want to do that. I want to address one thing that was come off that about the business community. I don't know, I mean, say bringing the business community, there are the small businesses that are going to have one set of expectations and needs. There are the building owners or the tenants of the large buildings that are going to have totally different sets of expectations and needs. So we need to concentrate on the types of businesses if we're going to do that, to get feedback. We don't want to get them all in there together.
That's fine.
What
yeah.
Are you thinking of?
Well, I mean, I think what Shelley just brought up is a good example. We're not experts on everything, so there are things that we overlook. So if we're talking about starting with ground signs only and nobody wants a ground sign, what's the point on even going forward with the ordinance? That was my concern. You know, we need to bring in the people who this is actually going to affect.
So
rather
what are
than
they, in other words, what do they think that they need?
What do they think they need?
Right.
Yeah, exactly.
Right.
Perfect.
Okay. Opposed to what we want.
We can maybe meet somewhere or
okay.
Whatever.
I think you're fine, though. Thank you very much for all the hard work and for counsel for all taking through the valuable
and with the business community that includes the nonprofit organization.
I support that.
Well, let's say all of the stakeholders.
Yeah. Right.
So. All right, gentlemen, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Just a couple of things. I'd like to first express our appreciation to the honorable body for the quality of the discussion. A lot of good suggestions. I'd like to also thank people on the team. This was a team effort. Obviously, Sue's been into this to a great depth, and Terry Crowe and Fred Zorn also participated in the preparation of this presentation and in the review. Appreciate that. I'd like to also indicate that we have about 50 people in the room. So anyone who has a sign that they like or dislike or any comments, egardella@cityofsouthfield.com. What's your extension?
4117.
796-4117. Leave a message. I'd like to also suggest through the Risk Management Authority that provides our liability and property insurance that we, I will take the assignment of contacting them to review all the litigation in this area. We are exemplary in our risk management and in avoiding any tax money going for litigation. We're also interested in the health, safety, and welfare of all that enter our city. So we'll do that. That's available to us at no cost and part of the member services that we're entitled to. I think we accomplished quite a bit tonight because we showed the soft side of building department a little bit, gave some evidence that they've done some heavy lifting, their homework, and I think council has noted their expertise. So with that, I think we should plan to come back with some recommendations. It's obvious that the people on the team have earned the right to express their expert opinion and come with some recommendations. Lastly, I would like to raise the bid to 6 months and call council on it. It's okay to take 6 months to do this. Sue Ward indicated 6 is a safer.
We could certainly get the ordinance for the new technology on the gas station. That could come back almost immediately. So that would at least provide.
I'd just like to say something about that. I've been approached by several people, owners of gas stations, and they're going to like this in the winter, so they might be one of the ones that we want to give a priority to if we can.
How many days for just that piece?
Well, that
we've
already
got it
they drafted.
60 days?
Oh, probably 30.
Days.
Whenever you guys want to do it, it's
30.
Already written.
All right.
Yeah.
60 at the most, and
okay.
Probably a lot less on that piece.
Yeah.
And then 60 days, 6 months
on
everything.
The other thing, Mr. Gardella, I want to make sure, you said you've done some research with other cities. I think that's an important component about the other cities in our general area, what their experience has been with some of these things.
Okay.
So
I can contact them.
Yeah, some of that
sure.
Would be good. Okay, I think we've covered that pretty thoroughly for this evening. We're going to go to item number two, and I'm going to ask Mr. Cassie if he would give a report from the Finance Committee. Mr. Cassie, and then I think we can follow along.
Council members, the committee met, and the purpose of this was to review the expenses that that the employees have in the way of cars or car allowances, and Mr. Shred gave a report, which I think is one that that makes this almost zero cost to the city in time. The history is that back some time ago, we looked at the same item, and there were some 22 cars that were driven by employees. This is now down to 8 vehicles, with one going to the administrator, or additional to the 8. We went to the administrator, went to the city attorney. The 5 of 8, the remaining 100% are paid by the employees, and what is asked is that it stretches this 3 years to the vehicles. In other words, instead of a 3-year program, it's extended by 3 years, and that the program can be re-upped, keep the same vehicles for even longer. So I think that the consensus of the Finance Committee was that this was a cost-saving endeavor by the city administrator, and that it's fair to the employees and acceptable, and I think this is should be endorsed by this council.
There were two other matters that possibly would be helpful for information that we did at the Finance Committee.
Did I skip one?
Personal property.
Oh, you want me to go into that?
And just briefly, because
well,
we did a lot of work.
Yeah,
we
believe
we
that.
Well, don't give him the whole enchilada, because we did some heavy lifting on this,
but it comes down to... I am so mad about this that I can't say, because, it is a short summary of the way I feel, that Southfield has been isolated as far as how this is reviewed in relationship to communities. There may be some exceptions besides Southfield, but when you look at the piece of legislation and you start looking at what has happened to this city by Proposal A, Headley, federal revenue being discontinued, both revenues have been cut back. One almost eliminated, the statutory and the constitutional. And then you get a hit on residential homes values, and then along comes the 320 appeals, which are going to cost the city, if it all goes to heck in a bushel basket, to $18 million. And then they throw at you the personal property tax on top of that. And what it really gets me is we have 30 million square feet of office. That is, some of the larger cities don't have that much office space. And the legislation states that anything that is less than $80,000 with the value is to be exempted. Well, out of the 30 million square feet of office space that we have, I just usually think about 75% of the office space is going to be eliminated from being taxed. Well, that's another $8 million. So there's six of them. So, I keep adding these numbers up. The $18 million, the $6 million, the $8 million, the revenue sharing cuts, and all this package, and then we have a some 60-some million-dollar budget, I don't know how the city can exist. And, I mean, we got to five mills, and that money is gone. It's gone because values have declined to such a degree that whatever was gained is lost. And the next thing that we are going to have to do is to cut more employees. And, I mean, we have really gone to the limit with the 200 employees that we are presently down. You know, I mean, I just don't know where we can cut without cutting services. And we've been, up to this time, exhausted our employees to give better and more service than we used to give at a higher tax rate. And I think that is going to be jeopardized by this piece of legislation. And I guess that was my report to this group, is that I really think that somebody has to go talk about the Southfield story, because the way they look at it, like there's look at bedroom communities and manufacturing in Dearborn, but nobody has looked at the uniqueness of this city with 30 million square feet of office space. And what that effect is going to be when they hit us, and you know, it's immediately going to cost us $750,000 right off the bat. And then, over a period of time, it's going to be totally eliminated. So unless they start finding a way to give money back to this community, and I'm going to say that, I mean, under Proposal A, they stole 20% of our commercial base and gave it to other communities. And they have not replaced that. And here they come at us again. And this city has been hit harder than any city in this state. And it seems like nobody identifies that in their discussions with the Senate, the House, the governor, or anybody else. And I don't know, you know, what we can do. We have the lobbyists here talking about it. And you know, he doesn't see any relief coming. And that's the story. It's a sad story to see a city that was developed in such a manner that we were the strongest community in the state to be hit so hard as almost a curse on this city. I don't know why they have not looked at all the cities in relationship to what you are. And my last thing was, why in the world, if we had known this was coming, would we have built the city the way we have? I mean, what was, and I don't understand the state, why would you want any development? Why would you want anybody to come into your town and build a plant when you know that all that new stuff is going to be exempt from personal property? How are you going to give them fire and police protection and snow removal and all the services we provide when they don't pay taxes? Mm-hmm. I mean, they'll pay some taxes, they'll pay on the building that they're in, but the bulk of it, I mean, that for 70 years we have been collecting is now going to be gone. And why build all these office buildings? Why should we allow any small businesses in our city, which is going to start the economy, according to all the economists, they need small business, and yet here you got $80,000 that is going to exempt if you're a small business. So I don't want any small business in here. I got to give them the same service. You know, I mean, so the whole piece of legislation, I don't think has really been looked at from Southfield's eyes, and I'm going to go to the banking on the second and try to talk to some of these things, but SimCog is supposed to give me a kind of a little note, like a little kid that I'm supposed to push their venue, and I'm not ready to do that, so I've got have some discussions, because if I go there, I'm going to tell the Southfield story.
I think the key here, as far as the hope on this legislation, is rather than try to defend the tax of this existence, is the Michigan Municipal League's got a good slogan and a good stance, and that is replace, don't erase. Mm-hmm. In other words, we need replacement revenues. They want to change the tax system and make it more business friendly. Mm-hmm. Fine, that's not what any of anybody is resisting, that I've heard, you know, from any governmental units, but we need replacement revenues. And so the ideal has been put out of a constitutional approach to guarantee. There's a recent idea for some townships to connect it to the state income tax, offer some sort of stability. But that's where we have to keep our focus and be in a leadership role on this, these replacement revenues. We did show up for the rally in Lansing. It was lightly attended, and the reason is I think a lot of communities are discouraged. But you got to march on. We went to the hearing in the Senate Finance Committee. They were not even lukewarm to the suggestion of a guaranteed replacement. However, I think we've got to get very aggressive at pushing the agenda of replacement revenues. I don't think there's any future in resisting or trying to defend the personal property tax, but we need replacement revenues, and they need to be a source that makes sense. These tax credits you're talking about, I don't think will provide much of a percentage or much long-term stability for replacement funds for this project.
Don and Jim, I don't understand the demeanor of our representatives, our senator and state rep. Can't they do anything? Don't they realize what's happening to our city? Why are they allowing it? I don't hear anybody speak up. I don't hear any decisions from our representatives or anybody. What is happening up there?
The way I look at it, and I'm obvious, it's a dumb deal. It's a dumb deal. It's just a matter of...
But how can I think that way?
Well, you've got a legislature up there that doesn't, you know, to me, they have no idea about the problems that they are asking local governments to incur, the cost. We all look at it. I don't know how many cities they want to see go bankrupt.
Mm-hmm.
Because, you know, we were at the, and some of us were at the 8 Mile Road Boulevard, for example, and the four, the City of Detroit, Macomb County, Oakland County, and Wayne County executives spoke. There's nobody from Wayne County that wants it. Nobody from Detroit wants it. Nobody from Macomb wants it. The only one that spoke in favor was Brooks Patterson. And I don't know where he's coming from. I guess he's supposed to be out about $19 billion. By it, and I don't know why he feels that he can cough up $19 billion. And I don't know why he isn't sticking up for cities in his county. Because it's to me, it's overwhelming. As the Hackle said in Macomb County, all the cities have gone against his proposal. Now, that's a lot of cities.
Is it possible that the state wants to change the local governments and put them under a fiefdom of the state?
Or go regional.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they want regional governments.
Is that what they...
Well, the dashboard kind of, you know, when they say that they want you to collaborate with other communities, you know, I made a list one time of what we have done since the 72.
151 examples we have.
Yeah. I go right off the legal page. I mean, there's so many of them that we have combined efforts, privatized, and done everything you're supposed to do to operate and preserve this city. I mean, everything. I mean, we're 200 people short. We did it by attrition. We didn't lay off anybody. We had privatized our jail. We privatized our ice arena. We started the recycling center with all these other communities. I mean, you can go on and on and on and on
But we started dashboard way back in 72. And now they're saying, well, what have you done for me lately? Well, when you've exhausted everything within our region, where are you going to go with it? Then you're going to tell me, put on a carrot and tell me, well, we're going to divide it into thirds. If you do this, little boy, you get a third. If you don't do this, little boy, we're going to give you, you know, take that away. Or we're going to give you two-thirds, or we're going to give you all of it. I mean, it's treating the cities like we're little school kids.
All right. We are basically a sovereign city, correct?
Well, no, you are.
No.
Now
you're broke.
Well, we are, allegedly. Do you mean to say that we can't do anything to tell them, we can do something, we're a sovereign city, you can't do this to us, and stop them legally?
You're chartered by the state. Our charter is approved by the state.
You're going to approve, all right. Tell them we'll CC from the
state. Here we go.
Jeremy probably can tell you what's happening up there better than I, because Jeremy probably can answer your question better than I.
Okay, well, I don't want to opine too much as it's getting late, but, you know, frankly, the partisan toxicity of Lansing is the problem in this, that, you know, we have a state rep who I know, I think, emailed out to all of you the Free Press editorial that he wrote speaking out against it,
mm-hmm.
But, you know, you can make the most logical, rational argument, and you were right, you hit the nail on the head with everything you said, but when you have an administration that wants to push an agenda and can get the House, the Senate, the Supreme Court on board, mm-hmm. You know, if you're a member of the minority party, mm-hmm. it's tough to do anything else, and so that's what I think the constitutional amendment was the approach. I've heard of different groups, including MML, pulling petitions. It would be a citizen-driven process. We would all sign up for it, and they would have to gather a certain amount of petitions to present to the board of state board of canvassers, which just the other day threw out the emergency manager in a partisan vote.
Down
so,
partisan
you know, they'll find something. It was font size with the emergency manager. They'll find something. You know, the T wasn't crossed the correct way. So, on a local level, it would be absolutely fruitless but effective maybe if we could just pass a resolution, you know, from our city council and send it to the governor. You know, you have your state senator and your state rep are completely on board. I can tell you that. It's just both of them are members of the minority party in their respective bodies. We could pass a resolution. I think that
why
would.
Why don't we do that? Why don't we initiate that?
But I've already done homework.
Yeah.
For the fact.
Yeah.
I have another idea. And don't laugh. We will be sick with Pam Gerald and Stephanie English to Lansing.
Let me say this, though. In what Jeremy said, he's telling the truth. But let me say that. Somebody has to say that, you know, when we pass this, down the road somewhere, you're going to have to find out when all these cities go broke, how are you going to deal with it?
You're
going
to take them
over.
Yeah, but
they don't even have enough experts up there. Look at the guy from Pontiac who's already saying, well, I can cut the budget, I can move numbers, but I can't do anything positive to make cities stronger.
Right.
So, it's like a one-sided coin. I can just cut everything, cut costs and everything. It's like.
But I will tell you, I was invited to Lansing, Urban Core City, and it was all the major cities in Michigan. And the governor fundamentally stood there, looked us in the eye, and said, "We're going down the right path." And the mayor of Dearborn, the mayor of Flint, the only mayor that was kind of soft was Grand Rapids. They got this unique relationship. Every mayor was telling him, and he just stood there and says, "This is a positive path, and don't be negative." That was his response. He wants positive comments because we're on the right. And you know, you're sitting there and you're blue in the face, and I told him.
I don't know if he knows the numbers. Jim has now got down to the numbers, and we've got some.
He doesn't care.
Well,
He doesn't care. He feels that he's doing the right thing, and his only objective, just like this personal property tax, he says justified because we're helping business. And if we help business, we're doing the right
but
thing.
But my argument is that if you were to build a city today and that was facing you and you had to knew that that amount of money was coming in to your city, and that's your startup money, so to speak, that if you've seen that you weren't going to receive some revenue, you would build a city differently and with the dollars that you had to expend based on your revenue, cost, you know, and revenue, balance your budget. But there's no way on earth that we would have now 30 million square feet of office space, knowing that they're going to take 75% of it, or give $11,500 for students so they could take 20% of my commercial.
But, you know, the one thing that I think that we have missed the ball on, the only people that seem to have the ear of the government is the business community. We need to hammer these chambers and get them to understand. You may have, wow, we're getting rid of personal property taxes. Guess what? When you call 911, you're not going to get it. We're not going to plow your streets. And if the business community seemed to get it and start speaking collectively with us, that's the only one that the governor hears.
Well, let me give you a good example. We had 8 additional policemen down at Northland.
Oh, I know.
Had an incident.
I know.
This guy's appealing his taxes. Mm-hmm. All right? And my attitude is, years ago, they used to have their own police department. Mm-hmm. They ran a good shift. They were community-orientated. And today, they're none of those. And when they get in trouble, you know, they call the law. I mean, they not only had city, they had, as I understand it, the state, the county, Oak Park, Detroit, Southfield, all of that involved in either that or by standby. And they tied up all these departments because of an action of somebody that is appealing their taxes. And I'm saying is, you know what? I ain't sending anybody down there. Burn the sucker. You know, I mean, I'm getting to that beat. You know, whatever happens, you go ahead and get your own security people to handle it.
Just send them a bill, that's all.
I want to ask Mr. Ross,
have any communities drafted resolutions that you know of?
I do not know. I'll investigate that. I do agree with
and
that.
And then maybe really talk to some of these businesses and tell them, you know, what we cannot do for them. Because I don't think they really understand what it means to them, ultimately.
Yeah.
Just looking at that bottom line, but there's a lot more that they depend on than that.
But let me tell you about the signatures. What happened, they didn't get that the proposal approved by the Board of Canvassers first.
I know.
They just went ahead and rewrote it. So,
right.
So my, you know, when we had a proposal on, we've always gone to the Attorney General to check and our proposal and see whether or not that was a go or not. And they would change it, put their 2 cents in.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm saying is that same manner, we go to the Board of Canvassers and said, I want you to approve the contents of this proposal.
Yeah.
And the wordage. And now you go.
And
do it.
Madam Chair, because we still have items to discuss, can we may put this as an agenda item on another meeting so that we can discuss it? Because
we'll do a resolution for the 14th.
I just wanted to say one thing. I hope we get a healthy discussion, but I think it's coming down to Southfield City itself in terms of the revenue that we've lost. I think we're going to have to look at increasing the revenue, looking for new pockets of money in the city. I'm going to come back to fee-based parking on this contract. Although it may be a small amount, but my study's shown we could literally have about $500,000 a year.
But you're really going to push us into an income tax and we're going to push us into.
But I'm just saying, we have to do something. We can't just
discuss.
We've got to start doing something.
We have an in-house parking expert now.
Okay, good.
Did you get that list for us?
One for a workshop.
Okay.
Major workout.
So it's Christmas coming.
We're not done discussing two.
number two. Oh, you're right.
Nowhere in here, I would like to know, where are we with the cars that, the eight cars, what is the gas allowance for those cars?
About 6 gallons on average a week.
And I'm sorry, but I've forgotten how that program works.
Okay, what we've done in the new program is we have a requirement that the employees contribute $30 a month, which totals up to $1,080, which would cover repairs or incidentals. And that's one of the incidentals. We don't think we need that much for repairs, but also in the assumptions that we did this on carbon depreciation, all of the research we did said between year 3 and year 6 of the age of the vehicle, the depreciation is 45%. We put 50 in this model to provide a little extra safety in our assumptions. So I think we pretty much covered
it. So explain to me, someone who's in this program gets 6 gallons of gasoline per week for free?
That's part of it. It's not free. They're putting in additional dollars. First of all, the city is exempt from a lot of the taxes that go from the gasoline,
right.
So it isn't quite as expensive as that pump. In fact, it's quite a bit less than that pump. And second of all, we don't think we need $1,080 for repairs. That's why I cut the program in 6 years, because cars and vehicles are under warranty for that period of time. When you go much beyond that, in fact, when we were discussing this, internally, there was a suggestion that we stretch it out even more, and that could be done at the end of this cycle. If council deemed it appropriate at that time, because it's based on basic business principles of depreciation, amortization, and cost recovery. And they would hold, whether you kept the cars for 8 years, 10 years, or whatever. The reason we pick 6 years is normally we do this on a 3-year cycle. So that's just the way it's been designed in the past. And secondly, vehicles normally are the drivetrain. Protected and other larger repairs. So
well,
we did think of all the elements when we put this together.
I have been opposed to this program for the last 10 years. I bring it up annually, and I really think it's time to totally drop it. To me, I appreciate the phasing out, but I cannot support this. I think it's time to end it totally and get out of the car business. I've said that many times in the past. I have no problem with paying people mileage for company business when they're on company time. I don't have a problem with car allowances, but providing cars, I'm opposed to. And I don't think that this goes far enough. I think it needs to cease this year, totally. Let's get out of the car business. I don't know how we can continue to have a car program when we have 200 positions unfilled.
Mm-hmm.
We're talking about concessions with retirement, health care, and maybe wages. If you know, we just had a discussion about all of the revenue we've lost. This is a relic. This program was started in the 1980s when we were building high-rise buildings. We had the money coming in hand over fist,
mm-hmm.
and that's long changed.
Mm-hmm.
I think we need to get out of this, and I can't. I appreciate the concessions. To me, it's not enough. It's time to end it, and I will not support this.
How much is the total cost to the city? I know it comes down to zero.
$6,000 a year. Basically, that's for the, it's zero for the five administrative employees.
Yeah.
Okay, that would be for deputy city clerk, deputy treasurer controller, community relations, purchasing agent, assistant, and assistant city attorney. And the cost for the other three vehicles, which recognize the need for the elected officials for their community presence, and a little higher burden there, they're cut by 50%. So it's a savings of about $6,000 a year. And again, a car allowance is more costly than doing it this way.
I'm not convinced of that, Jeff. Especially if it's just mileage, reimbursing mileage. I'd like to see the mileage that some of these positions are using. And I just don't favor gasoline for these cars either, buying gas, even if it's less than, I know we don't pay the tax.
Yeah, I just wanted to chime in here because I don't disagree with what Councilman Seiber said, especially with, you know, if you know, I don't think anyone's wrong in this scenario. I just think that in a program that started in a different economic time, if we look under the scope of we're starting a city brand new today in 2012, would we have this program a part of it? I don't think we would. So under that scope and under that idea, I would agree with my colleague on that. That I just don't think that fits the scope of any, you know, even if the cost savings isn't going to holistically make up our loss of revenue, it's a start. And I think we need to look at things moving forward. If we wouldn't start them up today in this economy, is it something that should be continued? And sometimes we'll say yes, and sometimes we'll say no. And for this, I think we should be out of doing something like this.
Yeah, I just disagree because these same individuals who have these vehicles for years, Jeremy, they have given up their pay increases to be in the program. So if they compound what they gave up over the years in pay to get into this arrangement, because I know when I had a car, they used to pay, you know, rent to lease the car, it used to be 100%. And today, you know, they pay how much, Jim, on their vehicles?
The
lease?
The five employees are going to pay 100% of the depreciation.
Yeah.
That's, so zero city dollars, okay? Plus $30 a month to set up a reserve for repairs or incidentals. That's the way it's set up. The only city dollars involved are for the three vehicles that are assigned to elected officials, and that's in recognition of the fact that they have a higher need for presence in the community than the administrative positions.
You want to do a roll 10?
Yeah, there are a couple of these leases that are coming. Some of them are coming due, and either we're going to continue with keeping these vehicles. No new vehicles here. Nobody's even asked for that. If we're going to stretch these out, then we need to make a decision for us to own them and then charge the employees so the money goes to the motor pool.
Okay, back up just for a minute, Jeff. You said the three positions that are holding the vehicles, what are their costs again, the elected officials that are holding the cars?
What are they paying?
What are they paying?
$25 a month in one case, $112 a month in another, and $113 in change in another case. These have not, are not, and never have been free vehicles. These are these are vehicles where the employee participates in the cost. Now, we are talking about used cars here. We're not talking new cars. We are talking about the depreciated value where we up it from 45 to 50, which means the employee has to pay the 50%. Okay, that's a safe number because we will get either we'll get that money when these vehicles either sell or somebody leaves. They have to, if they want that vehicle, they have to purchase it at the amortized appreciated price at that time.
That's for all the positions.
All the positions.
Okay.
So there is no chance the motor pool is going to come up short here or the public's going to be supplementing these vehicles for the five people. That's a given.
For the five.
Because we built so much in here. Now the employees, their payments are so $94. This is a month, by the way. $207, I'm rounding up here for pennies. $138, $140, $141, and $154. So these are not free vehicles.
So you're saying the phase out is going to be after the lease expires, we're not going to renew the lease.
We're not.
And the employees will have an opportunity to purchase.
They can purchase if they'd like. Or they turn the vehicle over to the motor pool, and the motor pool will sell the vehicle.
And we're done.
And we're done.
And all of these leases are set to expire.
Now, the leases right now are expecting are going to be expiring over the next 6 or 7 months. So the motor pool will then own those vehicles. And so now it's the burden of the employee to pay all of the motor pool's costs. I'm talking about five. The three officials, elected officials, do get some subsidy, but it isn't much. It's only $6,000 a year. Okay. And that's, again, because they have to be in the community and they have to be out about, okay, more than the, you know, some of the employees on the list. So that's the rationale there. Those are all the facts. We've had, maybe 6 or 7 people read this and review it. We put the numbers up for grants in terms of people challenging them. They hold up. This works. It's based on essential business practices of depreciation, amortization, and cost recovery.
Basic
principles.
I'm seeing the flip. I see that the some of the releases would be the five.
Yes, there are a couple of them that expire shortly, but in the next probably 6 months, all of them might expire.
I think my aim is toward the three elected positions that we should look at, because they're elected positions. I think they should be the first one to make the session with this.
That would require $170 a month more from each. People.
That's the way I should see. I see it. Where the concessions come first from you.
Well, you already given a concession.
No, I mean out of it. You get a salary, I think that's high. Your salary should be sufficient. I'm talking about the elected position.
Okay. I do want to make a note that these are not all of the vehicles that are assigned in the city. There are many others who have vehicles. Some are contractual, your city attorney, your city administrator, your attorney and administrator. And you also have vehicles that are not coming up for these. This is a small snapshot of it. And, you know, it's hard to have a conversation when they're talking about you. There are, this was something that was done when times were good. There is not a city that has a travel and to have transportation issues not compensated in some form or another. And I don't know what they did. I think the mayor of Lansing, and he opened up a fund and asked the community to pay money into it, and they did, so he could have a city car. Some kind of way, it's happening different ways in different cities. Brooks Patterson still has a driver, and he still has a car. He claims it's not a city, it's not a county car, but he still has a car and a driver. And the driver is on the city, is on the county payroll. So I don't know. It's just if your desire is to eliminate the program, it should be some form of some of these people don't do any driving for the city, and I understand that. But there are some who are required to drive constantly for the city, and I know I'm one of them. So it's the conversation needs to be about the whole picture. Your fire chief and police chief, you talked a lot about the folks in public works who take home city vehicles every night. There's a number of folks who are driving city cars, who are driving up to the pump getting gas before. So this needs to be a complete discussion and not just singling out. That's the only thing I want.
Yeah, sure. And, we've had the same discussion over a long period of time. And Jim can probably correct me because I don't recall all the things, but we extended the amount of miles on the vehicles so we don't buy vehicles as often as we used to. And we did curtail some of the individuals who are not emergency needed to give up their vehicles. They don't take them home. So we have looked at this over a series of time, and each time we have changed the cost of vehicles. And when Jim presented this to us, you know, I thought this was a means that we could approve because it ended up as a zero as far as cost to the city. And if somebody wanted to do that, you could say after the sixth year that, you know, that it'd be done away with. So there's a transition out of it, which would, you know, be a compromise between those who want to get rid of the program in itself. But, you know, I guess I just feel strong that at times when things are starting to get tight, there's a lot of people who their compensation was a car. And then they went ahead and took that car that was compensation and cut into that, where they start paying more and then more and then the more. And now this has gone down to a point where in 6 years, it's eliminated. In 6 years, the car turns in and they lose whatever is there. And so it's like leasing a car. The 6 year, and your lease comes up and you turn your car in. So I just, for $6,000, I mean, I just don't think that, and we're tightwad, I'll tell you, but for $6,000, I can find a lot of things that we approved that was not affecting our employees, I could find that $6,000 in many things that we have approved, you know, including art. You know? I mean, where do you want to cut off the money? I know things are getting tough. I just spelled out, but happening to the city, but you know, and I think we've cut into contracts, we have cut into everybody who does business, all the vendors, to save a buck, and I think that you know, this should be approved as submitted by the administrator, and reviewed in the next budgetary. A year from now, when budget is 30 years from now, and seeing where it goes. But, you know, in Hemantura, we get out of, in 6 years, we get totally out of the picture. We have to, you know, something that I can throw on the table.
Trevor, you want to go first? Yeah, no, I'm listening. So I'm not, I wanted to spur discussion, so I didn't come into this with, you know, my mind made up completely. I would love to see then a discussion move towards, and in 6 years, we're done. Or you know, any which way to get us out of this program, I mean, sooner rather than later. You know, I don't want this to be something that, you know, in 6 years new council just talks about. I don't even think in good economic times this is something that we should be really, you know, being in the business of. So, you know, how do we get there?
Put it in the resolution.
And is this for all eight vehicles, or is this for the five, excluding the three elected officials?
Who are contracts?
This program, no, that's not even in this group.
No. Not either.
Eight positions involved here. Three elected and five administrative positions.
Yeah.
And basically, if that's the will of council, just add a sentence to the resolution that says at the end of this period, you know, it's the vehicles go and there'll be a discussion of a car allowance or whatever.
Starting up a new, whatever,
rolled into people's compensation, or whatever. However, we'll be looking at it at that time. But if the will is that we're, you know, not having administrative vehicles or vehicles for elected officials, then that can be put in the resolution.
I'm comfortable with that.
Well, I disagree with it, Jeremy, because you're new, and I was having this conversation 10 years ago, 11 years ago, and we're still here. And yes, it's been greatly reduced, but, you know, somebody's paying $85 a month, that's $1,020 for a car. It costs me more than that to maintain my car. I don't, you know, between oil changes and brakes and you name it, whatever you have to, you know, you have to do to a car. The other part of it is it's an appearance issue.
Yeah.
I just think that this is not something that we should be doing, especially in these economic times. And I understand how we got in. And I remember the controversy.
Mm-hmm.
And the coverage in the local press 25 years ago when this program started, there was quite an uproar in the community about it at the time, which I think got all forgotten because it just became business as usual. But I don't want to name positions, but some of these folks, sure, they may have to drive someplace, but whatever the government mileage is now, 52 cents,
mm-hmm.
I would rather pay them 52 cents
mm-hmm.
to drive their car someplace when most of the time they're desk-bound at City Hall. And yes, it used to be worse. I mean, there were a whole number of other positions here that were included in the car program. When this started, it became a Me Too program. Well, if this person gets it, okay, then why don't I get it? Then the deputy should get it. And, you know, it really, to me, was not a good program, and it was sort of out of control. I'm pleased that we've come this far in, but I just think not another year. Let's end it. Just chop it off. It's done. I don't favor it.
Yeah, I'm listening to the discussion, and I do think there has to be a point of phase out, and I don't know if that's going to happen tonight. But I'm wondering if we could put, with this resolution, that effective July 1st, 2013, the management car allowance in and we give a small compensation for mileage allowance for this group.
Let's talk about it, if I could, through the chair. Let's talk about a mileage allowance of whatever the federal rate is.
Or a set amount, so let's do both.
That would, in essence, if you remove the whole concept of an allowance, okay, forget the vehicles for now, just an allowance. That was part of compensation. So you're going to take a certain group of people and give them, in essence, a compensation reduction. Okay, that's what we're talking about here. That's what we're talking about. You're going to take a. So it would make more sense to just say the thing ends at the end of this period, or, you know.
But how would there be a compensation reduction if we're then going to supplement or give them?
Well, if you give
a
car allowance, that's different.
Not a car allowance, but
there was a fixed amount that people got. They got it because they gave up certain things that they used to have. Okay, they got it because they don't get paid for overtime and other issues. Okay, so that's why they originally got something. Okay, the question is, should the notion was you get a certain number of dollars, okay, as car allowance. You can take those dollars and apply them against the vehicle, the base vehicle. Okay, and anything above the base, you pay out 100%. That was how it originally started. Or you can take it in cash. It's in your paycheck. That's the way it started. There was a scale of how much people got. And basically, a lot of folks pulled out of the program because, you know, there's people that decided, I'd rather have a car allowance than I don't need a vehicle. I don't want to apply my car allowance to a payment on the vehicle. So that's how it originated. That's how it was designed. Guaranteed. And that's where we are.
We have the two-tier system too. All new employees don't get.
Yeah, new employees get car allowance. But
yeah,
they don't get 50 cents a mile. They get a car allowance.
Yeah.
And it's part of the compensation.
They don't get a car.
They do not get a car.
Yeah.
They do not get a car.
Yeah,
they do not get 50 cents
so
a mile.
Already,
they get a certain number of dollars.
Have,
I understand that. It's all part of this incremental thing.
Yeah.
I've just lost patience with it, quite honestly.
Yeah, well,
and, you know, you can have all your own opinion.
Yeah,
that's how
yeah.
I feel. I've
yeah,
lost
well,
patience with this. It should be done.
Well, there's
I'm
no way
with
that
it.
This can be done easily. Unless you do a transition with a transition.
I want to say something. I want to say something. Way back when I first got on council, which was 1994, the employees that got cars that were all taken home to drive had an injury management people. At that time, the cars were provided as part of their compensation because it didn't cost the city anything. It was part of their compensation. It wasn't a free car. It was easier and cheaper for the city to give them a car than it was to pay them the money. It was part of their salary. Just so you understand, this isn't like freebie cars. I don't know what it is today. I don't know how, because I know how it's evolved, but I don't know. Probably it's not part of their salary, but it was at one time. So it's not like they just got cars. It was an inexpensive way to give them, meet their salary requirements, because it didn't cost the city.
And I appreciate that. Yeah, that's why I think the discussion is important. But, you know, I just wanted to say that I do share the complete concerns of Mr. Seiver. But, you know, 10 years ago, I don't think there was a 10-year
mm-hmm.
vision to get rid of this, unless I'm mistaken. Now we have that vision to get rid of this entirely. And I think that if we can add an easy caveat that this is the last time we look at this ever again, I'm comfortable with that. So, you know, I know you've been pushing this for a while, but now we have that end in sight. And if this is the way that I'm just looking for a practical way of applying it and the most reasonable way of doing it. And if one sentence added in there, you know, says we don't see this ever again, I'm comfortable with that.
I think, we are under different economic times than when this was initiated. But I can see a phase out. Let's see, with 1 year, this issue.
1 year won't work because that will put the motor pool. Let's see how that would work.
Give us a good phase out. I know you've got here.
They figured that 3 years would phase everything out.
3 years.
Zero. 3 years would guarantee that that motor pool would be made whole. That's how it works. And I'm not sure if it would work at 1 year. I'd have to look at it. But we base it on 3 years because A, cars are under warranty for that long, which major issues. And B, it's news. You know, what the way the thing is set up traditionally, and see, you can work the numbers that way. I'm not sure it'll work in 1 year because of depreciation. You'd have to recalculate it.
I would be in favor of the 1 year thing just to make sure that the numbers have matched, and I'm sure you've gone over those. So, seeing adding the recommendation of putting the phase out as the
statement. So, resolution would have basically this is the final cycle.
Is that
factory
with you?
It could be done.
How many cars are we talking about?
Eight cars. Basically, this represents a 60% reduction from what it was
in previous years. $6,000
a year.
Joe, let me add one more thing that I forgot about. When Tom used to give merit increases.
Right.
No
merit increases. You don't go off of a pay wage scale. Okay. There are some departments that are down 30, 40, and 50%. People are still pulling, getting it done. And it's a small group of folks. Those are facts.
And let me say one other thing. These people have no contracts. They're in automobiles that are figured into most contracts or allowances or things. So they've been have the advantage over these other people because, you know, whatever their role is in the city, they have been under contracts. And some of these people have received cars under the provisions of the contract. So these people have been in limbo as far as being organized to get anything other than what they have given by this council. And I just have a lot of respect for these people who have, in a lot of cases, taken the role of deputies or acting and doing two and three jobs now that they didn't have to do before. I mean, I think the morale of these people, knowing the total situation of what's going on internally, how can you ask people to do more and more and more and more and then kick them in the butt, you know, at the same time? I can't see, especially when it becomes in 3 years it's going to be, there's no cost to the city. These cars are turned into the motor pool, and the motor pool sells them for whatever the value is, and retrieves the money.
I'm going to go back to my original thing. Elected officials should be pulled out. The elected officials are the ones that need to take the discussion.
I don't disagree.
I think those are the ones.
Just look at employees. Employees only, the five employees. If you went back to, for example, a car loss, take one of the smaller ones, say 150 would be one of the smaller ones.
No, 150, yeah.
On the 150, okay? That costs 150 plus Social Security roll up, okay, of 78%. So you're up to, say, 175. Okay? So the city would have to give that person a check in their payroll for $175 unless it was totally taken away, okay? Now, get under this program, okay, it would cost the general fund this many dollars,
think that that is, that's happening all over.
I'm only worried about our people. I don't care what's all over.
That's fine, Sid. You talked and I was quiet. Now I'm talking. It's happening everywhere, and it's not about the people. It's about what everybody's having to do in the public sector, period. Everybody is taking a hit that has a public sector job. And I applaud all the people here that have stepped up and done more with less. And it's not about punishing them. It's just I can't support providing gasoline and a car in this day and age. And I really think that if you track the actual mileage that people are using, need a car for, it would be a very different story. Use an example that's not on the table. Years ago, the deputy librarian got a car. She never left her office unless she went to a regional meeting once a month or something. Why were we, because we could, and it was part of the program then. Well, times have changed. So, again, I want to be clear. I am not after anybody, but I just am uncomfortable with this program. I've been uncomfortable with it for years, and I think it should be based on mileage. And now we're and actually probably if it had been dealt with years ago, we wouldn't be and taking care of people other ways, then we wouldn't be in this. Now we're punishing people or it's punitive. That's why I wanted to get rid of it years ago. Well, everybody.
We're talking more concessions.
Joe, let me just say this. If it took the $100 over the 12 months, you're talking about $1,200 per person. It comes in at $100 a month. That's $9,600. So what I'm saying is that we're going to pay them an allowance at tune of $9,600, wherein it's taking the whole program costing $6,000. I'm just throwing that. So if you talk about $170 a month, now you can go even deeper in the hole.
But you don't have to do that.
What?
You don't have to have that kind of allowance. If it's based on actual mileage, then we'd have some data. We don't have that data.
Well, I'm using a very conservative figure at $100.
Yeah, but I question yeah. that. It's, but we don't have the data to say whether I'm right or you're right.
Mm-hmm. Well, I just know I go down to Economic Club about once a week, and I get mileage. What is mine? About $18, something like that, Terry? $18. So I'm talking, say, around about $70 a month right there. And that's on the Southfield business.
Absolutely. And when it come before council to vote on it, I voted.
Yeah,
in favor.
But I'm just trying to talk numbers here.
Yeah.
So I go down the tax, transportation, that's $18. So, I'm just trying to say, is it cheaper one way or the other? I guess that's what I'm trying to say. So I think if people, have to go up to the county or the Lansing, I can see that dollar amount.
I think we need data. Mm-hmm. We need to find out where these people have to go. And I'm not saying they shouldn't go, but, how often do they travel? What are their needs? We decided to give certain employees vehicles to take home because we saw a need for it. And we've all lamented some of the people really drive very far to go home with their company vehicle. And we've all had a little qualms about that. But we said, you know, if we had an emergency, we expect these people to be here with a truck, with the tools on it, to be able to go, you know, immediately to work. And so we're, you know, we decided that that's the best thing to do.
The worst scenario is that if you end this now, what you do to these eight individuals is take their car away or offer it to them at whatever the market value is and force them to cough up the money immediately, either to buy their own car, turn this into the pool, or to buy the car they have. You know, and I think that would be a hardship on an employee in this economy to do that. I mean, I would say that the cars are in probably about, I don't know, the most average car probably was around $28,000, I don't know, something like that. So you got, say, 46% of it after 5 years is value. So it hasn't even gone to 5 years yet. So
let's see. Residual value. So I'll go down the list for my position. One of them is $16,000. They'd have to bring $16,170. One of them is $4,573. That's the lowest paid employee in this group. They'd have to bring $4,573. Another person would have to bring $18,153. Another person would have to bring $18,231. Another position would be $12,730. Another position would be $7,780. And another position would be $79.62, and finally $89.40. So those are the amounts that people would have to bring because we are going to make a workable home. That's the whole concept behind this. So that's the case. They would have to be turned in. That's what they would approximately have to bring up here. To own the vehicle, if they wanted to buy the vehicle.
So how do we move toward the most practical way of transitioning this out for good with keeping that sensitivity in mind?
Just roll this out for the next 3 years. It doesn't cost you anything, and it pays out, you know, the whole program is. It'll be in the resolution there.
You would need to add that to this?
Yeah, add it to the resolution.
I would like to see that added.
The wording would be then...
No,
this would be the last cycle of this program.
Yeah.
The end of this program.
Right.
I mean, I think that's the healthiest compromise, reaching the sensitivity of the fact that it is a perception issue, which it is, and the fact that we shouldn't be in the car owning business, or car whatever you want to call it, and also meeting the sensitivity to the people who have the car already.
Yeah.
And that's the end of 3 years.
Yeah. I think that's fair.
So
last cycle of this program.
Mm-hmm. The only issue I wanted to bring up is that if the body chooses to do that, is it going to be limited just to the people who are in this their list? Or are we out of the current program?
Let's put in that resolution,
yep.
And that we further go and review all automobiles that are being taken home by all, including
that's
contracts.
Fair, because there's numbers of them, as Councilman Cyrus indicated, and you know, carry tools, have to be on call, et cetera, et cetera. The general direction of all of this
mm-hmm.
is downward in terms of cost
right.
of the vehicles. Motor pool budget, the budget that the mayor is under review in the mayor's office,
mm-hmm.
has a motor pool going down over 6.6%. So I don't know exactly where it'll land, but it'll be down more than 6%.
And John, move on rules 10.
With the amendment.
With the two amendments.
Sorry, you're right.
Well, we have to do the rule 10.
That's right.
All right,
Jim, just for clarification, this would be the last cycle of the management group car allowance, be it further resolved at a review?
Last cycle of having a vehicle option.
grabbing a vehicle.
Okay, because you mentioned, okay. This will be the last cycle of the, because you call this the management group car allowance. So this would be the last cycle of the management group car allowance?
Vehicle option.
Yeah.
And the other caveat is that the entire subject
all vehicles.
Further review of all automobiles in the whole of school budget. Anything else?
That could be right, Jim, in the motor pool?
All vehicles. Any take-home vehicles.
Is a motion for a rule 10?
Motion to rule 10, so we'll do
it. Is there support on it?
Supported by Mr. Jordan.
Aye.
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 Mr. Simon?
Yes. Mr. Chair, I'll make a motion that we accept the letter that's been transmitted to us by the city administrator, inclusive of the two resolutions, one being that it just be phased out in year six, and that a study be done on all other vehicles that are taken home by employees.
Motion by Mr. Patassi, supported by Mr. Jordan. Nancy, did you get that?
Yes, thank you.
That last motion, all right.
Aye.
Who supported?
Aye.
Nay.
And Ms. Jordan?
Yes.
And Mr. Ryan? And I say yes.
Madam Chair?
Yes, I do think we should take a break.
Yep.
I would like to ask Tom, because it's so late. I don't think it's fair to the planner or to the council. It's such an important discussion we want to have with our planner on position priorities. I'd like to postpone that. Yes, the next call.
Can I make a recommendation on that? It could be the first thing instead of, you know, getting lost in the shuffle.
Well, we never expected this.
I agree with you. I just want to make sure that, you know.
First, and
On the 7th, we have community development block grant.
And if I did, then
The resolution,
No, I'm in favor of that. I think it's something.
Well, I'd like to see it on the next regular council.
And there was a frat on
it. Cyber by the you do mean the super PACs. That's what you're.
Right.
Yeah, yeah, that's what you're saying.
Fracking and super PACs. It didn't get on the agenda for some reason.
But you went on television.
Right. And we had a meeting, televised meeting last week. I expected on the agenda. Or I thought it was. Secondly, I understand that the Finance Committee met, and we haven't heard anything about, is there going to be a fundraising program for the Nature Center that was referred to the...
referred to the
Finance Committee, rather.
And it's in the research.
Okay.
Now, there is a fundraising effort, but it's still in the research.
Because people had to ask about it.
Well, it's in the research.
Sorry. And then I understand that the Chaldean Festival, negotiations underway for a contract for the Chaldean Festival, and this year they'd like a beer tent.
We got to deal with that on the 7th, too.
Okay.
I just talked to Doug Black. There's issues.
I felt it merited a full council discussion and not just a finance committee discussion.
Well, we usually done that in a full council.
Well, no, we didn't discuss that at finance.
No,
we
that?
We won't.
What's that?
Oh, no, that
didn't come to
full council. I totally agree with you.
Okay.
We need to put it on the thing. We need to put it on the...
No, that was not set for time.
Yeah, I just got a call before this meeting from Doug Black.
Yeah,
and they're having issues. One of them is a beer tent, and there's a couple other issues. So
that's where you want
it. I thought we would deal with this.
And then I wanted to say, Jim, I appreciate your notice of bribing. I didn't realize that you were not copied on that email to the Bribing Neighbor Association about the...
We had this morning a major workout on that issue. Okay, we're going to put Mr. Rosenthal in contact with the Albanian, and we're going to try to work out a better solution. 100, I don't know if the number 100 is accurate, but even if it's a quarter of that, we cannot have 25 calls to our dispatch. At dispatch, all dispatch lines are for life-saving issues, and we need to guard the time and the services accordingly. So we will reach an agreement with and the other thing, and we'll talk about later when council is done with their comments.
In regards to that, also is that I'd like to make sure that they have their own security, trained security, on site, too.
I just had a quick question. So there's something else now on May 7th. I just want to make sure we have enough time, because we were all so passionate about it at the end of March to really discuss it. And I just feel like if it's going to be on another lengthy agenda, there was discussion I heard. We have previously held Saturday workshops or something like that. Is this something that we want to get more hands-on in? That's really worth an open-ended discussion, because when the time rolls around to this late, we're cooked. And so that's why I would even go to revisit that. Putting it on a different day entirely, just so we can work on it on its own. It's a pretty hefty and important.
What about a Thursday?
You're talking about planning?
Yeah. If we're building a huge thick May 7th schedule.
A Thursday would be good.
Thursday's good for me.
The 7th is loading up now. All
exactly.
I had originally was block grant.
Exactly.
We need to discuss the Calvin Festival situation.
And that's fine. So yeah, so I just want to make sure.
And also, we're now getting
that as a priority.
Oh, we can start
the meeting
earlier.
Right?
So you want that? Yeah, we can start the next five earlier at 5.
We start the meeting earlier.
Start at 5.
Okay.
And put planning on first.
Exactly.
Can I make a suggestion that we make we vote on that tonight? So
you have to do a roll 10 to move the meeting.
Right.
What night are you talking about now?
May 7th. May 7th.
May 7th. May 7th.
Wait,
you
made a motion.
Supported by Mr. Cyber, I vote aye.
Aye.
Who made the motion?
I made the motion.
I
Cyber.
Who supported it?
Cyber.
All in favor? Who supported it?
Aye.
All in favor? Opposed?
I move that the time of the start of the meeting on May 7th of the Committee of the Whole starts at 5 p.m.
With
Mr. Crow being...
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed, motion is carried.
And that's really start at 5.
Yes.
Okay.
I'm in.
Who seconded it? I'm sorry.
Cyber.
All right, anyone else? Any other business coming before the council? Any other comments?
Mr. Shrek.
I just want to advise council that because there was some negative publicity on it, there was a carnival at Northland. There were some issues there and some potential violence, and it did get on television. And I just want to indicate that our police force did a tremendous job, all phases. And we first of all, they monitored social media, and that's where a lot of the information came about some gang activity that was planned. Our police were proactive. They were there. There was so much commotion that the Northland people asked us to provide more personnel. And we said, sure, we'll provide personnel, but they're on overtime, and we need to be compensated, which they agreed to do. And then they asked for more, and they challenged whether they were going to pay for those folks or not. Okay, well, we will send them. Mr. Lance said, send them an invoice. They'll be getting an invoice today. And what we needed to do, because of what occurred and some other procedural issues, is we did close it down to zero. That's what you have. They have apparently come for a permit, which they should have done in the first place. Right? Nancy, they did come in for a permit now. Okay, that's going up through the police department.
Yes, it is. Police department, fire department, building department.
Right. And we'll do it as soon as we can. And if they meet the requirements, they can open back up. If they do not meet the requirements, there's basically two words: you're closed. There are two phases here. Northland had to go to the zoning board to get a special use.
Temporary use. Parking lot. Okay. Well, other than a parking lot.
So that was done correctly. But what didn't get done is all the procedural requirements for the carnival.
The carnival did not come in and get a carnival license. They did not.
Why, why doesn't Northland get it that this is not a good activity for their center? And we shouldn't be supporting this, whether it's a special use for a day.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it harms all of us. Thankfully, what I read online, most of it said 7 Mile in Detroit, and the only mention of Southfield was that there was a fair at Northland in Southfield. But you just can't do these things anymore.
Oh, we had that shoe episode.
What bothers me is it put our police officers in harm's way.
Sure. And they're down there, and if somebody has an emergency up over here,
that's right.
Where are our people?
Yeah. And we had a high level of deployment over there to keep this thing from getting out of control.
Feeling the taxes.
It's a shame that you can't do these things, but the truth is, stuff happens, and I don't know. They don't seem to get it, and then we all suffer for it.
They had a police department down there. I don't know if it was a large one originally, wasn't it?
I don't know. One of the requirements was they'll have to bring a lot of their own security. They won't do it.
The Northland Police was a big deal. They were almost as big as we were.
They were there.
Right,
they were there.
All right.
Just in case you were contacted, I wanted to correct you.
ending on a positive note, I just wanted to report that our Shred Day on Saturday was a huge success. We serviced over 933 vehicles from 10 to 2. It was probably the best event as far as flow of people that we had. People were very complimentary, and it was nice to see some of the elected officials and also the school people out there.